Welcome to Hollywood, California, home of the stars. Welcome to Wildcard Boxing Club, home of legendary stars like Hall of Fame trainer Freddie Roach, world champions Manny Pacquiao and Miguel Cotto. Welcome to Ring City, USA, where rising stars earn their stripes in crossroad fights with careers on the line. And Saturday night main events just a win away.
It's the original entertainment capital of the world, Hollywood, California, home to a boxing mecca, the Wild Card Boxing Club, which plays host to tonight's third edition of Ring City USA, live on NBCSN. And there is the Hall of Famer Freddie Roach, who came here 25 years ago to set up this beautiful gym for aspiring fighters. Tonight, we have another loaded card with fighters hungry, looking to take the next step. We've got a main event featuring two fighters with perfect records. And in the co-main event, the women take center stage, Mrdjenovich taking on Torres. As we bring you outside the gym, underneath the stars here on a beautiful crisp night here in Hollywood, California. Hello once again, everyone. I'm Todd Harris, alongside the two-time world champion, Sean Porter. Well, Sean, what a year it is to be in the business of boxing. We've had great fights in the last couple months. Despite the pandemic, it rolls on. The folks here are doing a fantastic job of making that happen, and it really could all culminate with a great boxing tournament in Tokyo this summer.
Right. I mean, we had Mike Tyson and Roy Jones. Errol Spence Jr. just made a fantastic comeback. Triple G, Canelo this weekend. The sport of boxing is very much so alive during these times, and it is alive right here tonight.
All right, we have got a main event for you tonight. Someone's O must certainly go because they are both undefeated. Let's talk first about Charles Conwell, who comes in and he brings so much to Ring City, USA.
You're right. He's young, vibrant, very energetic in the ring, very powerful in the ring. Look for him to use his power tonight and control the action.
Speaking of power, his opponent, 14-0, Ashkeyev, he is no slouch.
This is a dangerous fight for Charles Conwell. You're facing Maskayev, who is a ring general himself, aggressive himself. I mean, this is going to be a clash of the titans tonight. I'm looking forward to it.
In the co-main event of the night, the women take center stage here under the stars in Hollywood. Jelena Mrdjenovich taking on Torres. And I don't want to go on a limb too much here, Sean, but this could be the fight of the night.
Listen, it very well could be. These ladies get after it. They love to fight. And guess what? Somebody's walking away with this ring with the belt.
That's all important. So that'll be the co-main event tonight. Jelena Mrdjenovich, 52 professional fights to her credit. But if it hadn't been for a serious basketball injury while playing for the University of Alberta, her boxing history would never have happened.
For people who think 52 fights is a lot, it is. But for me, I think I'm just getting started in this next phase. 19 years ago, blew my ACL playing basketball, kind of was rehabbing. I walked into a gym, and this is way back when it was the age-old, like, women shouldn't really be in this sport kind of story. So I started just working out on my own. Milan was a family friend, and he's like, how's that boxing going? And I said, well, it's good. I'm just working out in the gym by myself. And he's like, unacceptable. He's like, I'll see you at Panther Gym at 3 tomorrow. Don't be late. And the rest was history. You know, I think a lot of people expected me to retire with the news of Milan. And for me, you know, I think this is my opportunity to show people how great we really are. I am a pioneer of our sport. I've fought around the world. I've won 8 world titles. I still feel like there's so much more for me to do. Jonathan's amazing. He challenges me. I think we challenge each other. This is the first camp where I can actually 100% focus on boxing. So I think this will be the best version of me that the world has seen.
Ladies and gentlemen, entering the ring, the defending world champion, Jelena Mrdjenovich.
So the Canadian fighter making her way on a crisp evening tonight, Sean. And you talk about the fighters and how they have to come in with a sweat. Well, she comes from the Northern Territories of Canada, so this cool is nothing.
Yeah, she says coming from Canada doesn't matter. She's looking forward to getting out here, and she knows she's got to get hot before the fight starts.
You talk about her experience, more than 52 professional fights, but I have to wonder if she's ever fought in a situation like this outside an iconic gym like Wild Card Boxing Club, and now she faces off in the evening outdoors. Right now, let's take a look at the tail of the tape for the co-main event of the night. Jelena Mrdjenovich, 38 years of age. There you see her weight. She rehydrated up to 136.8 pounds, 5'7", and her reach, 67. Paula Torres, 124.2. She rehydrated in her weight to 136. Her height, 5'5", and a equal 67-inch reach. We send it now inside the ring to Lupe Contreras.
We welcome you to the house that Freddie built, the Wild Card Boxing Club. Hollywood, California, this is Ring City, USA, presented in association with Bash Boxing, KO Boxing, and Davies Entertainment. This is our co-featured bout of the evening, set for 10 rounds. On the line, the WBA Featherweight Championship of the World. Our judges scoring at ringside are Dr. Lou Moret, Pat Russell, and Max DeLuca. At the sound of the bell, the ref in charge, Raul Caiz Jr. Presenting first, the challenger. Fighting out of the blue corner, she enters wearing blue with gold trim, her official weight, 124.25 pounds. As a professional, she maintains a record of 12 victories against 4 losses, 1 bout even, 4 of those victories coming by way of KO. Tonight, atop the Ring City, USA canvas, she makes her second attempt at the world title. Fighting out of Monterrey, Nuevo León, Mexico, La Fiera, Paula Torres. Across the ring in the red corner, the defending world champion, wearing black with red trim, she weighed in officially at 125.5 pounds. In 52 pro bouts, she maintains an outstanding record of 40 victories against 10 losses, 2 draws, 19 of those victories coming by way of knockout. Tonight, defending her WBA featherweight title, fighting out of Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, Jelena Mrdjenovich.
Fighter 2 second only, please, protector. Mouthpiece. All right, ladies, you received the instructions in the dressing room. Know what I expect? A good, clean fight. Ya recibieron las instrucciones con una pelea limpia. Legal punches, golpes legales, here for you. Here for you. Touch gloves, glove to both. You want to still lose this.
Raul Caiz in charge of the action here in Hollywood as we get set to go. The co-main event of the evening. Jelena Mrdjenovich taking on Paula Torres. This one's scheduled for 10 rounds.
Box.
Here we go. Sean, I got
Don't punch. Box.
Got to ask you right off the bat, what do you expect from Torres as she comes out?
Well, ask Brian Campbell. He's here with us. What do you expect, Brian?
Oh, we asked Torres, a native of Mexico, what type of fight to expect. She answered very quickly, my style is the Mexican style. I come forward. I stand and brawl. Jelena also likes that same style. So, guys, buckle up. This is going to be quick. We're getting some fireworks here.
Yeah, I think the one thing, though, with the punches and bunches that we're going to get, we're going to see both of these women try to set up some knockout punches and some heavy shots. That's what I really like about Jelena. She uses a good jab from the outside. She uses it to try to set up other shots.
Bring it up.
They're wasting no time as Jelena Mrdjenovich in the red and black coming forward multiple times. Not a lot of combinations as they get in. It's get in and then get back out.
There you go.
If you're looking at one thing that really separates these two, it's certainly the experience level. Mrdjenovich, she's been a champion of some form for 15 years, guys, and won 8 different titles in 3 different weight divisions, yet 53 fights into her career. This is her U.S. debut tonight. Yeah. And we asked her why. She said, look, you guys have been behind on the women's boxing game. She's had to stay in her home in Canada. She had to go to Europe, but she's here in the U.S. tonight.
I do know that she's happy to be here. And who else could she be here against but Torres? Torres is going to bring the fight all night. She's got that, like she says, Mexican style. It's a real style. Mexican fighters like to get after it. The Mexican style is a fighter who likes to go after it.
Torres has been on a long layoff since last year in August when she had a split decision win over Christina Fuentes in Laredo, Texas. So first round complete for Jelena Mrdjenovich and Paola Torres. She goes by the nickname La Fiera, but she's the most pleasant beast you'll ever meet.
Fue a los 15 años cuando yo pisé por primera vez un gimnasio de boxeo. Nació un amor por esta disciplina, por el box, cuando vi a dos mujeres por primera vez haciendo sparring. Mi corazón es mexicano. Soy un guerrero. Me siento más motivada porque sé que no soy la favorita, me conoce y sabe de mí. Saben que no va a ser una pelea fácil. Y pueden decir lo que quieran, pero yo me siento favorita en mi gimnasio y con mi gente.
Paola Torres getting set to come back out for round number 2. This one's scheduled for 10 with a WBA title on the line. Jelena Mrdjenovich, Paola Torres going at it. Good to have you with us here in Hollywood alongside two-time world champion Sean Porter, Brian Campbell, our boxing insider, and Kern Bhatia. I'm Todd Harris.
Gotta love that smile of Torres. When she gets in the ring, it goes away. She becomes a beast. A little bit more on her toes now this round, understanding that Jelena's not the type of fighter you can just go at. You know, you're not going to just break down Jelena. It's got to be more methodical.
She's so fundamentally sound, correct?
Yep. So now you see Torres moving, just simply trying to open up Jelena a little bit and set up some shots of her own.
No, that's fine.
Brian, obviously, Jelena would love to get this thing over quickly, but do you think it favors her if she can drag this into the later rounds?
Yeah, the experience difference between the two of them is huge, and certainly as much as Jelena can fight the action style, she's had a bevy of highlight reel knockouts throughout her career, she can also be the more technical fighter, which may come in handy here as Torres likes to push the pace in front of her.
I gotta say, I love this. Now the tables have turned. You got Torres coming forward, and now Jelena's on the move. Big right hand and hook there.
Torres not backing down.
She's going after it.
Tell you what, she is coming forward. Mrdjenovich feeling the fury of La Fiera.
Experience right there to tie her up. She feels the momentum swinging. She's going to tie her up, stop all that. And then back on the jab into the body.
Pace slowing just a little bit now for Paola Torres as Mrdjenovich tries to take control of the ring. Final 10 seconds here, round number 2. This one's scheduled for 10. We'll be back for round number 3 when we return live on NBCSN.
Back her up a little bit, okay? Don't let her come forward. Back her up. Tear that body apart, okay? Wear that body out. I saw it at the end of the round. She had shot her wide, but it was too close to the end of the round. So.
Welcome back to Ring City, USA. Jelena Mrdjenovich has had 52 pro fights, and all of those in her corner was Milan Lubavitch. He tragically suffered a cardiac arrest in February. He's been in an induced coma since then. She linked up with decorated trainer Jonathan Banks. But Jonathan was unable to be here tonight. He's with Gennady Golovkin. So she's now working with assistant trainer Rick Phillips and longtime friend Brad Switzer. It's been an extremely emotional training camp for Jelena. She says she wants to inspire people to keep going, even through the toughest of circumstances.
All right, thank you, Kern. Sean, I've got to ask you, as a two-time world champion, Jelena's got certainly the experience at 52 professional fights, but that is really changing your whole camp, not once, but twice.
I mean, but also, I mean, look at 52 fights. Nice. With one coach, but even beyond that, you've never had to go through this, through 52 fights, this kind of emotional battle that she's up against. And I am hoping that it doesn't play a role in this fight for her.
Well, Jelena basically came out and told us in the fighter meeting she expects it to, no matter what, win or lose. She expects a victory. She expects to be very emotional afterwards. And she's gone as far as saying, look, I've cried a lot in training camp, but boxing has been my therapy to get through a very tough time in her life.
And I'm loving this fight right now. I mean, the tables have turned once again. You have Jelena now going after Torres, and Torres is retreating, and not with as much offense as she had in the previous round.
See Steve Smoger's unofficial card. He's got one round each for Torres and Mrdjenovich. Sean, Brian, would you agree with that?
I gave you. What do you think, Brian? I gave the second round to Torres.
Well, look, you're always looking to vote against the great Steve Smoger here. How dare you, first of all. But I like Torres's pressure. I think the rounds in which she lets her hands go, she's going to have a much better chance. She's not making it easy for the champ. If she can keep this fight at close range, she can continue to be a factor on the scorecards.
The two things with both of these fighters, and I'm sure this is something that they knew, conditioning would be a big factor, and the pace of the fight will be a big factor. Whoever can maintain the pace is going to be the one who will come out on top.
Stop! Hold your hands. Be careful with your hands. Box. 10 seconds. Stop at the bell. Yes, segundo. Para la campana.
Very entertaining third round here.
Oh, wow.
Charge. Le regalaste la primera parte del ring por dejarle la iniciativa. Tienes que tomar la iniciativa, dar combinaciones, tirarle al mismo tiempo, que es cuando le estás pescando con volado. Póster volado con fuerza, ¿verdad? Dale, Lisa. ¿Cómo andamos? ¿Qué ritmo? Es el mismo ritmo. Ella se truena luego, Iranda. 4-5 rounds, va a estar tronada y la vas a apabullar, la vas a abrumar, ¿vale? Échale, mija, ¿cómo andamos? Esto, mija, te recuperas de volada, mija. Ella ya está cansada, está vieja. Si es cochina, igual, ella no va a cambiar. ¿Vale, mija?
Torres, she started the round off kind of slow, but near the end, she picked it up. You see right here, big left hook to end the round. Both these girls going back and forth so far through three rounds.
Three shots.
Round number four, this one's scheduled for 10. Picking up in round four, the way it ended in round number three with a lot of action.
And they get right back to the action. I can see Jelena aiming towards the body a lot more. I think that the focal point is going to be to slow down Torres.
A little closer.
Torres is well aware of what's going on here, the larger storyline outside the ring, the mental fatigues, the heartbreak of what's going on with Jelena in training camp. We asked her, look, is this the right time for an upset? All things considered, she said definitely. So you can look to see her continue to put on that pressure and really just not let Jelena be in control. That's going to be the key.
And you know that the interesting thing about the Mexican style is they look to get hit. They want to get hit. That fires them up. And I can see Torres, even though she's getting hit, she's still, that fire's lit under her, and she's trying to fight.
No fear whatsoever from Paula Torres in the gold and black as she continues to come forward and put the pressure on the more experienced Jelena Mrdjenovich.
I saw that Smoger had it 2-1 for Jelena. I had the same, 2-1. I mean, every round's close, every round's competitive, that's what we expected. And even more importantly, when you only have 2-minute rounds, it makes it even harder to determine who's winning the round.
That simply means you got to work. And we talk about often how this smaller ring allows you that opportunity to let your hands go. There's nowhere to hide.
You got
to
work. When I was amateur, we fought 4 2-minute rounds, and it was all a matter of who threw the most punches and who was able to connect the most of them.
Those are straight up cardio bouts, right? I mean, you're all in.
Yep, and that's exactly what this is. I mean, in a lot of ways, I can see a little bit of the strategy with both women, but it's more so about who's got the better conditioning in this fight.
Torres and Mrdjenovich, and they will go to the next round.
Beautiful work. Beautiful work. Those combinations is killing her. This is my piece. Small sip, small sip. Anytime.
Both of you are coming in with your heads, so you both gotta be careful, okay?
Anytime you shoot your combinations and then step out and box her, you make it an easy fight, okay? You don't need to be in there trying to see who the strongest. Right now you're working to be the smartest, okay? This thing is to win the fight. You shoot those combinations, dig on the body, make sure you bend, dig on the body. Okay?
Back in Hollywood, this is Ring City, USA. You're looking at Jelena Mrdjenovich. And there was an accidental headbutt over her right eye as a corner people cut man attended to that. You wonder if that's going to spur her on to try to end this thing quicker, Sean. But Torres is going nowhere.
When you get in that position, you got to figure something out.
Yep.
I got a feeling she's going to try to end the fight, and she's going to keep fighting the same way. If I was Jelena, I would try to get a little bit more space and use my boxing ability. She's a very good boxer, and right now she can't afford to put herself in harm's way.
Brian, this is a classic case of both fighters trying to impose their will. No one's backing down.
No, without question. Something Sean said there was very apt. If Jelena doesn't start working behind that jab to try to dictate the pace, she's got the experience. She's typically the ring general, yet she's in here trying to brawl Torres. That plays into the Mexican's hands.
Right.
Yeah. She's got to smarten up at this point. I think I heard the corner say it's about being intelligent. Be intelligent, get behind your jab, and keep Torres off of you. Keeps the fight cleaner, makes it easier to determine who's winning the fight.
Sean, while me saying this might be a little bit of speculation, is she fighting emotional in your eyes, knowing everything going on?
You know, even for myself, trying not to make that the case, I have considered that this may be emotional fighting, you know? That could be what's happening right now.
Look at that right eye.
I did see the setup. You know, I saw two jabs to the body and then overhand right. And then we see Jelena still continuing to go to the body. Torres is a fighter, and she's going to keep trying to come forward and keep trying to throw.
Good right hand from Torres. It's not orthodox. It's not traditional, Sean. It's mauling, but it's working.
Yeah, it's not traditional. It's mauling. I guess it could be traditional to the Mexican style.
Full on street fight here in Hollywood at Wild Card Boxing Club.
Wow. Big round.
The man himself, Freddie Roach, 7-time Trainer of the Year, as his former boxers and fellow competitors continue to pay the tributes to the man.
Mike, time.
Overall, I have a great respect for Freddie. He's a humble man. He has accomplished so much. Freddie taught me to put pressure on my opponents, to slip, go in, and finish it quickly. He taught me to have punching power in both my hands, especially my left hook. When he held the mitts, you were tired. When other people held the mitts, I didn't get tired. He wanted 200%. When you hit the mitts, he wanted you to go all out. Freddie, I miss you. I love you. You're a great friend. You're a great coach. You're a great human being.
Beautiful.
Great tributes coming in for Freddie Roach and what he's meant to the boxing industry. And we've got a good one on our hand in the co-main event. You are looking at Jelena Mrdjenovich, WBA title on the line. The 38-year-old, excuse me, has got her hands full with 31-year-old Paula Torres out of Mexico.
Wow, I mean, every round, meet me in the center of the ring. Meet me in the center of the ring, and then here we go.
Look, if you're wondering whether Torres has been here before, because very few fighters can match Mrdjenovic's experience. Torres lost a featherweight title bout in 2017 to Cindy Serrano, but it was a 2018 loss to Heather Hardy that really matured her. That was a fight in Brooklyn, New York on the undercard, Sean, of your victory over Andre Berto. And that was a fight in which not only did I think Torres had won, the entire Brooklyn crowd booed, even though Heather Hardy was the home fighter and got the win.
I actually remember hearing about that, and you see it now in this fight with Torres, coming out more jabs, more straight punches, not so much of the brawling, rock'em sock'em robot type of mentality, and it's been more effective for her.
Good head movement, Mrdjenovich, but Torres, to BC's point, continues to come forward, pushing the pace.
Both of these women. Somebody's got to hurt somebody.
Yeah.
Someone's got to slow the other one down. If they don't, it's going to be close round after close round. And it's almost like whoever the judge, you can kind of close your eyes and figure out who's willing to fight at this point.
Mrdjenovich might be the more tactical fighter, Sean, but it just seems like Torres is kind of taking her out of her comfort zone and fighting the fight that she wants.
I think so, but I mean, I've seen this time and time again from Jelena where she wants to be up on you. She wants to outbang you and outpunch you. And that's not what she needs tonight. She needs the basics. She needs a dip, make Torres miss, and then come with a counter hook. She needs more of the clean boxing tonight.
If you paid to get in here to watch this, you certainly got your money's worth into six rounds.
Absolutely. You see right there, Jelena's a little wobbly right now.
Round but able to finish seven. Strong. We'll have round seven when we return to Ring City, USA. Let's go back to the fourth round, gentlemen. This is the inadvertent headbutt right there that opened up the cut over the right brow of Jelena Mrdjenovich.
Yeah, buddy, you got two young fighters wanting to come at each other. It's bound to happen at some point. It's by accident. You know, it's not by design.
Right.
Both women just in there giving it all they got. And, you know, that's the case when you have two women trying to come right at each other.
Get your shots and get out of the way, okay? You're looking good.
These have been close and some very exciting rounds.
Good,
but if you're the champ, you are playing into Torres' strategy. You're allowing her to own the center of the ring, and you're basically fighting at a hellacious pace that Torres welcomes.
I agree. One thing I don't like to do is do the same thing every single round. I believe that you have to be a fighter that makes adjustments. And I don't think either fighter has made very many adjustments. Small, minor adjustments. And right here you see the adjustment by Jelena. Moving on the outside, using her reach. Now making Torres miss, and then coming back in with some shots. Here's the thing, you gotta be consistent with that. Torres is gonna pull her back in. I got a feeling Torres is gonna pull her right back in to that mentality of staying right there and fighting.
Well, we've got a moment. Let's check in with Kern Bhatia for a corner report.
Jelena was complaining about headbutts. Of course, we saw the accidental headbutt happen. Now blood streaming from the left side of Jelena's face. She told the ref, hey, that was a headbutt. He replied, Raul Caiz replied, I know it was a headbutt, but you're also coming in with your head down. I spoke to Jelena's corner. I said, what else do you want to see her do? They're happy with her work. They want her to keep backing Torres up and double the left hook. Back to you guys.
All right, thank you very much, Kern, as we get him down to the final 50 seconds of round number seven. Brian and Shauna, you guys surprised not only by the pace, but the fact that Torres' cardio is just spot on because she continues the pace. This is the same thing we saw from round one.
She has not slowed down one bit. I've been looking to see which woman is going to start taking some steps back and seeing their punch output decline. Neither one of them. They're both going in there and giving it all they got.
Well, Sean, you can see Mrdjenovich is in love with her left hook. That's her power shot. She has to step in to get the leverage, but each time she steps in, she's right in the kitchen. She's right in the line of fire, and it's not adding up. She's getting one, but she's eating 2-3 in return.
You're right, man. Both women, I mean, they're giving it and they're taking it. The cleaner fighter can keep each other on the outside. That's who's going to win this fight.
Wow. Sunday night, the push for the playoffs continues as Baker Mayfield and the resurgent Cleveland Browns. It's music to Sean Porter's ears.
Did you hear that,
they
drum
head to
roll?
New York to take on the red-hot Giants. Sunday night, 7 Eastern, only on NBC. Sean Porter will definitely be watching.
I wish I could be there, man. Listen, in the toughest division in football, the AFC, we're trying to do the best we can.
The toughest division?
Absolutely. AFC is the toughest division in the NFL.
You take away Kansas City, I'm leaning more to the NFC West.
Steelers, 11-2.
Look at this guy.
That's right.
Look at that.
2018. Hey, listen, that was the first win the Browns had in, I think, 2 years. And I was right there to witness it. Man.
You know, my whole job is just to get you fired up about the Browns, but you're already
there. Why would
you
do that?
You're already there.
It happens, man. I can't help it. I'm crazy about my Browns.
I'm happy for Cleveland and what they've been able to pull off, Baker Mayfield and company, and the game of the week, maybe last week against the Ravens.
Oh, yeah, definitely the game of the week. And this is turning out to be right now the fight of the night.
We talked about this at the start. Jelena Mrdjenovich and Paola Torres could be the fight of the night. This one with a belt on the line, the WBA title on the line. Mrdjenovich really going back to work because she's answering what Torres is doing, who's coming right, meeting her in the middle of the ring, and just throwing punches. Forget the strategy. Just come forward and throw leather.
That's been the strategy for both women tonight. You see a little more boxing from Jelena, but she can't maintain that type of boxing style because Torres is forcing her to fight her fight.
Just joining us, fourth round, inadvertent headbutt. That is the wound over the right brow of Jelena Mrdjenovich in the red and black. The younger Paola Torres, though, continues to push the pace. Both women, excellent shape with cardio.
You got to commend them for this cardio, this pace that they're able to maintain. And another thing, I see Torres's nature. Mm-hmm. I see her personality and her boxing ability. She's a fun, loving, very caring person outside of the ring and inside of the ring. I know it sounds the complete opposite because she's going after Torres, or excuse me, after Jelena, but it's her heart and it's her will and determination that's really showing up in this fight.
If I was going to give her a nickname, the Beast would not be the nickname because you see her outside the ring and maybe one of the most pleasant people in Hollywood this week, but she has turned in a tremendous performance through 8 rounds here. Ring City, USA.
Absolutely. And she's forced Jelena to fight her fight. You see Jelena trying to get some space and use some movement. Torres right back on her. And then what do you think Jelena's going to do? Fall right back into that same fighting style. She can't not fight back because Torres is forcing her to. It's a messy eye, too.
Yeah, they're going to have to address that during the break. Jelena Mrdjenovich, Paola Torres will have round 9 when we return.
Soy Paola Torres, bienvenidos a Ring City USA.
I'm Jelena Mrdjenovich. You're watching Ring City USA on NBC Sports.
Thank you very much, ladies, as we bring you back to Hollywood on a cool evening at Wild Card Boxing Club at Vine and Santa Monica. Jelena Mrdjenovich, 40-10-2, the 38-year-old, and look at this work.
Oof. You see that right there, straight punch into the shot. Do that, Jelena. Make this fight make it clear that you're the winner of this match. I mean, too many close rounds for both these ladies. The one who can make the adjustment is not making the adjustment. That's Jelena.
Round 9 of 10. WBA title on the line. And just when you think Mrdjenovich may have control of this fight, it looks like Torres just gets some extra energy and lands the punches.
She comes right back. Yeah, you have to admire it. You have to appreciate it. However, you have to understand that I can't win a fight by getting hit.
Yeah.
And by hitting someone and also getting hit.
Yeah. See right there as Mrdjenovich comes in with her head down, and she's warned once again about the inadvertent head coming in. It was her, though, with Torres that got the headbutt in the fourth round. That opened up the cut over her right eye. Good combinations from Mrdjenovich.
And even though Torres is slowed down, she doesn't have as much pop on her punches. She's still going to keep coming.
I think Mrdjenovich may be, in my opinion, the better pure fighter, but Torres is an absolute warrior.
Yeah, Torres is a warrior. And she's going to keep coming all night long, just like that. I mean, she's walking and punching. Yeah. And then right there, look.
I mean, she's still throwing punches even though she's out of range.
Jelena just out-hustled her. She felt it and just started letting her hands go. I mean, she's this is what she's here for. She's here for a fight.
Mrdjenovich now digging in, landing some great body shots.
Great body shots, great action from both women.
Final 10 seconds of round 9. So we will see a 10th and final round. Jelena Mrdjenovich, Paola Torres. This has been an absolute classic here in the shadows of the Wild Card Boxing Club.
I don't see her making out this last round. I don't see it happening. She looked like she wanted to quit. You see how she backed up away from you at the end? She looked like she wanted to quit. Okay?
Síguele tirando porque no, el señor no le está diciendo nada. Dale, mantenle el ritmo, mucha intensidad.
Here's a flurry right here from Jelena. Goes to the body, right back up to the head. And guess what? She's going to keep punching. She's taking control of the fight. But she does it better from the outside. I mean, right here in the last round, too late, I think, for adjustments. Whatever you've been doing to this point is what you're going to continue to do. I would look to see if Jelena, if she's going to try to protect the eye and play it safe and stay away from Torres. But it's a close fight. I don't know if she can do that.
And here we go, the 10th and final round. Jelena Mrdjenovich, Paola Torres. Sean, if I would have put your season tickets to the Cleveland Browns on the line, that this fight would have gone the distance, would you have taken that bet?
Yeah, I would have. I would have taken the bet, understanding who these women are. Seeing the punches that they've taken,
yep.
I would have tried to take those tickets back immediately because you would have thought that one would get caught clean. But heart and spirit and the will to fight is what both of these ladies have.
Mrdjenovich once again.
Good jab.
And she takes a straight jab.
Good jab. And the even more interesting thing is when one of these women, once they get hit, they feel it and they feel like they have to come right back. We saw Jelena just take a clean jab and then she comes right back with her own.
Torres continues to come forward. You see Jelena drop that left shoulder when she comes in, and that's when Torres has been able to come in, but that's also when that headbutting situation has occurred.
You know what? I do wonder that if, because these women know that they're 2-minute rounds, if they feel they have to fight this way because the rounds are shorter, which makes the fight shorter.
No matter where you slice it, that's still 20 minutes of heavy-duty fighting.
I'm telling you, 10 rounds of this, what we've seen for 10 rounds, you see most male fighters do in the last 10 seconds of the last round.
Try to steal the round.
Yeah.
Here we go. The final 20 seconds of this fight. All 10 rounds. What warriors? Mrdjenovich and Torres. Final 10.
Can they turn it up? I thought we'd see it. Great fight.
What a performance by both Jelena Mrdjenovich and Paula Torres. Those who are lucky enough to be here on their feet applauding those warriors.
This was very good for women's boxing, very good for those two young ladies. Showing what women boxing have to offer, you know, heart, will, determination, and on top of that, the same type of skill that you would see from a lot of the males, the men out there.
What a show. It goes all 10 rounds. Will it be Jelena Mrdjenovich or Paola Torres walking away with a WBA title? We'll find out when we return to Hollywood at Wild Card Boxing Club. Folks, it's time to get festive. Spend your holidays with 40 Premier League matches over 17 days on NBC, NBCSN, and streaming on Peacock. Premier League festive fixtures presented by Wendy's, now through January 4th. Beautiful night in Los Angeles, California, just 7 miles up the road here in Hollywood. You'll find Wildcard Boxing Club as we get set for the final decision, the official decision between Paola Torres and Jelena Mrdjenovich for the WBA title. As we sit inside the ring and Lupe Contreras.
After going the distance here at the Wild Card Boxing Club, we consult the official scorecard to determine a winner. Judge Moret scores at 97-93. Judge Russell, 98-92. And Judge DeLuca scores at 96-94. All three in favor of the winner by way of unanimous decision. Still WBA featherweight champion of the world, Jelena Mrdjenovich.
So Jelena takes her record to 41-10-2, but what a performance by Paola Torres. Really going the distance, Sean, and she got some big rounds off of Jelena.
Yeah, I mean, I could see that Torres was a little disappointed that she didn't win this fight, but when you are coming forward and eating shots as well as delivering your own, you don't show to the judges that you're the better fighter, that you're winning those rounds. A lot of close rounds in this match. Jelena using better boxing ability and catching Torres a little bit more on the outside. But the whole fight was back and forth. Jelena going to the body, then guess what? Torres coming right back the whole night. Right there we see Jelena using jabs, straight 1-2s. At the end of the day, end of the night, that's what the judges like. That's what the judges want to see. When the judge is able to see that you clearly have good boxing ability and can hit someone from the outside, you get your hand raised just like Jelena right there.
And Jelena Mrdjenovich is now standing by with Kurram Bhatia.
Jelena, obviously we know this training camp was an emotional one. You didn't have your trainer, Milan, by your side. How are you feeling right now emotionally?
Oh, you had to go there right away, hey? Well, first of all, training camp, everything about this was difficult. I wanted an easy night tonight. I wanted to showcase my power and come out pretty. But Milan not being here was I can't even get into it right now, but I had a great camp with Jonathan and with Rick, and, you know, having Brad in my corner really carried me through the emotional difficult times. Before we were walking out, I had a little breakdown, and Brad said, get your shit together. So, I mean, I had to do that pretty quick. Yeah, I really wish I would have made it quick, but, you know, I know Milan carried me through this ugly cut and probably swearing at me right now, but that's okay.
And when did you first notice the headbutts were going to be a problem for you in that fight?
Round one. Like, I got one right on the top of the head, which I'll probably swell right away. But, you know, she was coming in. She's shorter. This isn't the first time. I'm a monster at 126. So, you know, it's not the first time. I've had 13 stitches here. I had amazing docs in Edmonton. So, L.A., no pressure. But we need some good stitch work today. You know, she kept coming in with the head, and I tried to dig that body. She looked soft from her pictures, and I thought I could get her, but she is tough. She's one tough cookie.
And you got through this tough fight with Torres, and of course the question is, what's next?
Listen, now before you answer, this is my night tonight, Kieran. I don't even want to talk about it. Right now, this was about me getting out of here mentally and emotionally safe. And you know, we're going through a tough time right now with COVID. I'm going through a tough time with going through depression with Milan. And this isn't about anybody else. This is about my night tonight with my new family, with my people, my new fans here. I don't care about anybody else. Let me celebrate. You guys, 53 fights, 8 world titles. I don't even know how many defenses. Give me a minute.
Before the fight, you said that you wanted to keep fighting to inspire people. You certainly did that tonight. Jelena Mrdjenovich, congratulations.
Thank you so much, you guys. If you are ever going through any trouble, just one foot in front of the other and get through it, because that's all we can do right now. Thank you so much.
Sage advice. Sage advice from the champion, Jelena Mrdjenovich, as she takes her record to 41-10-2. The 38-year-old took on a tough Paola Torres, and in the end, she reigns supreme, getting a unanimous decision as the fight goes all 10 rounds. Coming up next at Ring City USA, more great boxing as we take you inside the club. There he is, Freddie Roach, with his boxer, Narek Abgaryan. He'll take on Eduardo Baez when we return to Hollywood here on NBCSN. Just 7 miles north of the City of Angels is the town of Hollywood, where people from around the world come to follow their dreams. On the cross streets of Vine and Santa Monica Boulevard, you'll find the Wild Card Boxing Club. Founded more than 25 years ago by Hall of Famer Freddie Roach, he has welcomed aspiring fighters into his cathedral and let them know right off the bat, it ain't easy. For more on Freddie and his impact on the industry and the sport of boxing, let's check in with Kerim Bhatia.
Hey, Todd. Good to see you down there. A lot has changed in 25 years. One thing that has not changed is Freddie Roach's work ethic. Every fighter I spoke to said the same thing. Freddie is the first one in, the last one out. One thing that has changed, though, is the crop of fighters that Freddie is training. He's now training young fighters like Gor Yuritsian and Narek Abgaryan, who's actually fighting tonight. 2 weeks ago, we saw Gor in the corner, Freddie giving instructions. He imposed both stylistic and motivational and mental advice. That approach works perfectly for Narek, who told us this week he plays chess to prepare for boxing. I asked Narek, I said, what does chess do for you? He said, it's simple. In both boxing and chess, one wrong move can cost you. He'll look to make no mistakes tonight against dangerous Eduardo Baez. Baez is going to have a 5-inch height advantage tonight. For more on Baez, we're going to throw it out to BC. Now, BC, I don't know where you are or how you got up there, but I want answers.
Well, Curran, I'm high above the wild card at the moment. And speaking of height, you mentioned Eduardo Baez. 5-inch height advantage, 3-inch reach advantage. But is an advantage really one if you don't use it? That's the question facing Baez in this fight. The 25-year-old typically employs the come-forward Mexican style, put your head down and grind. But it was a chance sparring session with three-division champion and legend Roman Chocolatito Gonzalez earlier this year that opened up his eyes. He lit up like a Christmas tree talking about it, but Baez said it was a beautiful experience. But most importantly, Chocolatito showed me I can command the fight from distance using my jab. I don't need to go body to body. I can be much more effective. We're going to find out tonight if that strategy works. But speaking of somebody who knows their way around the ring pretty well, let's go over to our own two-time champion, Showtime Sean Porter.
BC, everybody wants to know, what's it like inside of the ring? Well, I tell you what, on the outside of the ring, we're human, just like everybody else. However, once we step into this ring, we transform. We become superheroes. And that's exactly what these guys are going to do tonight. They're going to be fighting against superheroes. But only superheroes, there's another element of surprise tonight. You got first, the weather. It's cold out here. Sun's gone down. It's chilly. When you're in there in the back room getting ready, warm up, get hot. You need those muscles moving. Getting ready to move the way they need to when you get in this ring. And even beyond that, we're not in the average size ring tonight. It's a smaller ring, which means you got to stay right here in the middle of the ring. Whoever can control the ring tonight, whoever can be the ring general, that's who's going to win the fight tonight. No dancing around tonight. You take two steps to the left, you're in the corner. You're right here. You take two steps to the right, you're in another corner. There's no laying on the ropes tonight. Whoever's in the middle of this ring tonight, it's going to be the commander, the chief, and that's who's going to win the fight. And for more, let's go to Todd.
All right, so now we have a lay of the land here at Wildcard Boxing Club in Hollywood, California. When we return, Ring City USA rolls on with another great bout. It's 14-0. Narek Abgaryan facing off against Eduardo Baez live here on NBCSN. We are back in Hollywood, California, Ring City, USA on NBCSN, Wildcard Boxing Club. Alongside Sean Porter, Brian Campbell, Curran Bhatia, Todd Harris with you as we get ready for our next bout, all leading up to the main event of the evening. Before we get to that, we want to take a look at the International Boxing Hall of Fame inductees. We heard a little bit from Lucy Reich earlier on. 2020 with a great class joining her, Bernard Hopkins, Sugar Shane Mosley, Juan Manuel Marquez, and Christy Martin. And guys, announced later was the 2021 group, and the folks from 2020 did not get their opportunity to be inducted properly, so hopefully that will take place next year. But how about this year's class? Floyd Mayweather, Klitschko, Andre Ward, Leila Ali, and Ann Wolf. I'll get your thoughts on that, Brian, and first we'll start with you, Sean.
I just feel like they put everybody in it between 20 and 21. I mean, who else is there left to go in?
Yeah, it's hard to be on the outside looking in. Miguel Cotto just missed James Toney as well. But you talk about Mayweather and Klitschko, 1996 Olympic medalists going in together.
Let's take a look at the tail of the tape for this next bout in the 120s. It'll be Narek Abgaryan and Eduardo Baez. And there you see Abgaryan, 28, 120, 125 after hydrating, 5'4". And there is what Brian talked about, that height advantage, reach advantage going the way of Baez, who is 25, as we said it, inside the ring. And Lupe Contreras.
We continue with the action here at the Wild Card Boxing Club, Hollywood, California. This is Ring City USA, presented in association with Bash Boxing and Punch Boxing Promotions. This bout set for 8 rounds or less in the super bantamweight division. The judges at ringside are Dr. Lou Moret, Pat Russell, and Max DeLuca. The ref in charge of the ring, Raul Geis Jr. Presenting first, the fighter standing in the blue corner. He wears black trunks adorned with the colors of Mexico, green, white, and red. On the scale, he weighed in at an official 119¾ pounds. Tonight, he enters the ring in his 21st professional bout with an outstanding record of 17 victories against one lone defeat, 2 draws, 6 of those victories coming by way of KO. Fighting out of Mexicali, Baja California, Mexico, Puro Chicali, Eduardo El Fantástico Baez. His opponent across the ring in the red corner, wearing blue with silver trim, he weighed in at an official 120 pounds. Tonight, he enters the ring an undefeated professional with 14 victories, six of those victories coming by way of KO, representing his homeland of Yerevan, Armenia. Narek, the dancing killer, Abgaryan.
Protector. All right, gentlemen, you received the instructions in the dressing room. Know what I expect? A good, clean fight. Ya recibieron las instrucciones que una pelea limpia. Legal punches, golpes legales, here for you. Legal punches here for you. Touch gloves, good luck to both of you. Buenas tardes.
And we are set to go. The most famous man inside that ring, Hall of Famer Freddie Roach. He'll be working the corner for that man, Abgaryan. He takes on Baez. This one's scheduled for eight rounds.
Listo. Box.
Here we go. And guys, I got to wonder if a guy like Eduardo Baez decides to come out here, maybe push the pace a little bit more, see if he can surprise Abgaryan.
Watch the head.
Very good jab by Mr. Fantastico.
You like that name, huh?
I like, yeah, I do. I wrote it down in bold print.
You're not changing Sean Fantastico Porter, are you, from Showtime?
Not at all, but his jab looks to be fantastic right now. And I tell every fighter, use your jab. Your jab is the most important weapon you
stop,
have.
Stop, stop, stop. You okay? Sounds good?
Fantastico's careful, okay? Fine, Sean, but his opponent's the dancing killer. How
you're
are you going to look over
killer,
that
yeah.
Come on.
You know, when you're the dancing killer, I just don't know what to expect from you in the ring. Are you someone who can use the ring and dance and move around? Or?
You had me a killer. Early on, though, Baez finding some success. A smart man once told me that a good jab can blind you.
By controlling the distance, controlling the ring.
Watch your heads. Stop. It's okay.
Another headbutt there. I think that's maybe three right there already. I think a little bit like the last fight we just saw. These guys are both, they're two come straight ahead type of fighters. And we may see more headbutts tonight.
This is a good start for Baez for all of those things we talked about. Standing upright, using that jab. He's darting in to land. He's getting out of trouble. Typically, he can be there to be hit in his previous fight, Sean. So good to see him navigate that distance well, like you talked about.
Absolutely. I mean, I think that's the number one thing. Are you improving? Are you trying to get your game better than it was in the previous outing? And using the movement and using the defense is definitely a big improvement by him.
Talk about the movement. Narek Abgaryan, who training with Freddie Roach, man, his footwork is sensational. Gets in, gets out, side to side.
That's the name of the game. I think a lot of guys lose track of that by trying to knock somebody out or by trying to hit somebody 100 times.
Careful not behind
in
the head. Careful not behind the head.
You got to hit and not get hit. Good counter right hand right there by Narek. And I think his game plan is to counter with that right hand like he just did and also get to the body.
Nice international field tonight. Ring City USA, last fight if you were with us. Mrdjenovich getting the win, the Canadian over the Mexican fighter. And here we've got Mexico versus Armenia.
Ring City goes everywhere to find
yes,
the
sir. That we got Showtime Sean Porter sitting ringside. Straight up legit.
10 seconds. Stop at the bell. 10 segundos.
The good round.
Good opening round for both fighters here at Ring City USA in Hollywood, California.
Yeah. Two. Five. Three. A little more combination, okay?
Yeah.
And one, two. Body, bang, bang, okay? Body, head, under, okay? All right?
Just moments ago, Freddie Roach down on his knee working with this fighter, Narek Abgaryan, says, take a deep breath, do this. And I found myself, guys, listening to what Freddie said, so I took a deep breath. Guys, that's smart.
That's how it goes. You gotta listen to the corner. Good job, Todd. The jab, I think, was the most important weapon for both these fighters in the first round. We just saw right there, Narek. However, Eduardo Baez was using a great jab of his own through the course of the entire first round.
Freddie Roach, the seven-time Trainer of the Year in the Boxing Hall of Fame. As we get set for round number two, Narek Abgaryan in the blue with the silver trim. Eduardo Baez, colors of Mexico.
What I like about Narek is he's in control. He's got Baez coming right at him. Mm-hmm. And in a lot of ways pressuring him, throwing more punches. But Narek is under control. He's seeing the punches that he wants to throw, and he's not wasting any of them.
Well, he's a very classy fighter. It's not just the footwork that Todd mentioned. His defense is always on point. He has a way of getting out of trouble just as the opponent is stretching forward and leaning in. Very good navigator of distance.
And there you see the scoring of Steve Smoker unofficially. He has Baez doing that first round 10-9. Baez, Steve Smoker said Baez was controlling the distance with that excellent jab.
And I'm seeing a little bit more of a dancing killer this round.
Yeah.
And you know, just because his name's the dancing killer, it's now about can you move. But you know, I do want to see that killer instinct, and I am starting to see him use more offense than he did the previous round. It's only the first round. You had to get warm, had to fill out the fighter. But now he's starting to find his range.
And to your point, before this fight started about getting warm, temperatures now dipping into the mid-50s with 70% humidity and a slight breeze. So as a boxer, obviously you come out, you've got a sweat built up, but that's got to be a bit of a challenge, Sean.
Yeah, I mean, I've done the best I could to tell all these fighters, keep your clothes on as long as you can, yeah. Especially when you come out here, because once it hits you, it's like a slap in the face.
Yeah.
And it's going to take a minute for you to really get warm.
Mother Nature doesn't play around.
A very good adjustment so far by Abgaryan this round. And it's all coming with that footwork. If you notice, we said Baez getting off early with the jab in round one. He's had a tough time once he sets his feet, finding Abgaryan in front of him. He can't find him, and that's allowing him to give up his height advantage where Narek can do much better work on the inside.
And he switched momentarily for about 20 or 30 seconds right there. And right there, he just spent.
Watch your heads.
Bias and then countered with a very good right hand and then right back on his bicycle.
Contrasting styles here in round number two. 40 seconds to go. This one's scheduled for 8. And going to Kern Bhatia's report on Narek and his love of chess and how that helps him. He seems to be a strategic fighter, guys. He's looking for the opening. He's going to take what Eduardo Baez gives him.
He's dangerous with both hands. It looks like he's very good from the orthodox position as well as the southpaw. He looks comfortable in both positions, and he's really showing all of the offensive weaponry he has. Good body, should look doubled up. Hook to the body, hook to the head.
Baez is cut.
And round two ends with a flurry. So Freddie Roach has taught his fighter well, and as he continues to do work in the corner, the tributes to the great man continue to pour in.
The best decision that I made my career was moving to LA, playing with Freddie Roach. Freddie was the most challenging trainer that I ever faced. He just wanted me to stay focused, stay on top of him at every moment, just trying to make me be working at every second of the round. You know, he's an amazing trainer. And most important, he's an amazing person.
High praise from Miguel Cotto, who, guys, I have no doubt that he's eventually going to be in that Hall of Fame.
Oh, no doubt. I mean, he was an Olympian, did amazing things as a professional, even reinvented himself with Freddie Roach near the end of his career. Fantastic fighter and human being.
So here we go. Round number three between Narek Abgaryan and Eduardo Baez.
Bring it up, stop.
Ooh.
It's okay. You okay? Just bring it up. Bring it up. Okay, here we go.
Box. Inadvertent low shot. And what you pointed out earlier, Sean, when we saw it in this fight earlier, both fighters tend to come in and they're dropping their level down, dropping low. So I'm surprised we haven't seen more headbutts or low blows.
You know what? Narek, he does it because that's a part of his game. That's what that's what he has to do. He's got to change his levels in order to make the other guy miss. However, Baez, you're dipping down to hit a guy. Use your long arms and hit this guy. You don't have to get as close as you're getting. And on top of that, you're bringing your head first, which is causing the head collisions.
Going southpaw again, Abgaryan.
Just switching up like that.
You know, here's the thing. He's shuffling his feet. It's almost like he's going to he squares up, shuffles his feet, and it's almost like he's going to go with whatever offensive side he's on is the foot he's going to put out front. He's very good from both sides. See, here's the shuffle, and then he'll stop right there. He's got the angle he needs, and now the right foot's out front.
Baez continues to come forward, and Abgaryan's footwork continues to be so polished.
See that? Look, Baez forced him back to the left. He just switched up, put his left foot out front, and takes a few shuffles to the left.
Baez showing good class here.
Yeah, for sure. Baez is showing good class. It bothers me when you have long arms, you got good speed, good jab, good straight punches, and you choose to get close to a guy. You don't have to. Why do these guys make the fights harder on them than they need to be?
Sean, to your point, is that frustration? Is that ego? Just wanting to do what you want to do?
I think it's a lot of doing what you want to do, and it's no secret. Baez says, hey, I have a Mexican style, and, you know, we've said it time and time again that, you know, it's more of a straight ahead style, and you bring the action. Bring your head along with it, and in turn, you take a lot of shots. Hey, don't
do that. And also, if you're having trouble tracking down your opponent who has phenomenal footwork that we've seen from Narek so far,
you're going to run into it all.
You're going to square up and throw eventually.
Yep, you're going to square up and run into it all.
So Abgaryan receives the warning, told if he does it again, he's going to get a point taken away. We'll see how that plays out.
He basically, they got close, and he bumped Baez off with his head. That's just... It's not smart. It's not something you should do. However, guys like that who understand this is a physical sport, they tend to use their head to bump a guy off of him.
10 seconds. Stop at the bell. There's a good
much better round by Baez, too.
We'll have the fourth round when we return to Hollywood.
Where are we going to? Three? Come on, suck it down, Mount Prison! Protector, watch your head. Cuidado con la cabeza.
And we're back right here. You see Baez, Narek, he's able to get Baez off balance. And then that's when he delivers his blows. I talked about the ring and the size of the ring, not being able to move. You can see Narek's gonna move. He's gonna be in the corner from corner very quickly, but he's got the conditioning that it takes to maintain that type of fighting style. And if you have the kind of conditioning it takes, you can box from the outside, have your back against the ropes like Narek is doing, and be able to turn your guy and get him in the positions you want him in. Right here we see it. This is a wide view of the ring. And you can see that the ring's a little smaller than most rings you see.
Unconventional.
Yeah. Right here we don't see Narek using the movement, but, you know, if we had seen this right here a little sooner during the wide view, you'd see that it doesn't take many steps for him to get from one side to the other. makes a difference in terms of your fighting style and what you can do and what you want to do.
And Brian, I've got to ask you, is this normal movement for Narek, or is he having to adjust to the more aggressive Baez, all the movement for him? And is it psychologically, you're kind of feeling like you're being walked down?
For sure. This is normally Narek can make adjustments, have the advantages and the craft and the footwork. And one thing we talked about, look, we talk about the Mexican style all the time.
Right.
It's an overused term. We said, what's the Armenian style? You know what he told me? He said it's a thinking man style. Fight smarter, not harder. And specifically, he said, we fight so that a brawl can and shouldn't occur at the end of the day. It's going to be interesting if Baez can keep cutting off the ring. We're going to find out right away if Abgaryan can fight as well as he can box on the inside.
And Abgaryan also said, hey, we don't want that firefight, but I can make it happen if I need to.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we've even seen that. We've seen him lay on the ropes. We've seen him fight back and things like that. But he's definitely trying to get room to think, and Baez is making that hard for him.
Eduardo Baez, in the black, green, white, and red trim trunks, continues to walk down Narek Abgaryan. And Abgaryan using more head bobs and feints to get away from him. And you see the cut on the forehead now of Baez.
Yeah, Baez has transitioned into full Mexican style here, but it is effective. Let's give him that credit. Punches and punches, cutting the ring off.
Yeah, I mean, I hope I didn't paint the picture that a Mexican style of fighting is not effective or doesn't work. The first fight with Torres, I just thought that she should have changed up and done something a little different. And I feel the same about Baez. I feel like he should get some distance and use those long arms.
10 seconds.
Take a look right there. Abgaryan, you're laying your head in there. You're asking for trouble when you do stuff like that.
Mira, tú eres alto, eres pequeño, las cabezas son accidentales, so tienes que cuidar los dos.
Esa güey, ¿ok?
Dame el mouse. Abre la boca. Estamos bien, Lalo, estamos bien.
Right here, we're coming back with a headbutt that happened in the second round. Baez, use those long arms. When you use your head and come straight in like that, both of these guys, you're asking for trouble. Narek doesn't mind. And then here's the very last round. There's that headbutt of Narek. He's just laying his head up there, and then he's using it kind of to bump Baez off of him. Leaves him with a cut.
Baez says, I'm ready to go. Entertaining fight so far through four rounds. Baez has been the more aggressive fighter. Abgaryan maybe the more strategic fighter.
I'm going to use this analogy. You know how when football teams, they run a screen
yeah.
and they want the other guys to come at them?
Right, right.
And then they toss the ball off? That's exactly what's happening right now to Baez. Narek wants you to come in. He
drawing
wants
him
you
in.
To overextend, and then he's going to try to capitalize.
He wants you to be an over-aggressive linebacker and come after it. Steve Smoker, unofficially, another round going the way of Eduardo Baez as we check in now with Kerim Bhatia.
Legendary trainer Freddie Roach, of course, training Narek Abgaryan. Between rounds, he told him, I want more combinations. Something else Freddie does is he will take a deep breath himself and have his fighters mimic that. He feels like that's the best way to get them to take a deep breath. In the blue corner, there's some frustration. They want Baez to trap Narek in the corner. They don't like that Narek is getting out of the corner. When I asked them, how do you trap someone who's moving like this? Sean, you're going to like their answer. They said, we want Baez to go to the body.
Yeah.
Back to you guys.
There you go. Go to the body, but I would even go a step further. Use your jab. You can use your jab. It's almost like a broomstick.
And
direct your guy. Direct Narek into the corners if that's what you want him to be. If that's what you want him to
be. Baez right now, I'm telling my trainer, thanks for the ideas. I'm doing pretty well out there right now, though.
Yeah, I actually have it 2-2. I'm not in full agreement with Smoker, but I can see, I mean, Baez is the more aggressive fighter. Both guys are landing punches.
But I just
don't feel that Baez is in complete control the way that Smoker is.
Abgaryan connecting on that big left. Baez, it looks like to me he's landing more punches, but are they damaging punches? Are they effective punches?
They might be. They might not be. But let's give him a credit for ring generalship.
Oh, no question. Oh, absolutely.
You do this in front of a judge round after round. Yeah. You're the aggressor that can win out.
Hey, I mean, yeah. I mean, you're the aggressor, but does that mean you're the ring general? I feel that good body shot there by Baez. I didn't think it was low like that. He's got a better game.
I mean, you make the dancing killer dance your dance, right? You make him fight your style on your terms. There's something to be said for that.
I can't argue with that, BC. I can't argue with that. I tried, but I'm going
to
let it go.
Baez seems to be slowing down just a little bit as we come to the final 20 seconds here of round number five. And I'll tell you what, it has been this same pace since round number one. Remember, this one's scheduled for 8.
Much tougher fight than I believe Freddie or Narek really expected coming in.
Good. Go ahead, Marvin.
Okay, it's right here, okay? All right. Uppercut, jab, okay? Jab's working really good.
Here we go, thank you.
All right, the jab's working really good for you, okay? Jab right here in the hook, okay? Good job. Under and out, stay off the ropes, okay? Stay in the middle, okay? Middle, box, okay?
And we're back. Look, right here. Straight 1-2. Connect to the end of the punches. Right there, Baez is going to win the fight. Can win the fight.
I don't think there's been 1 second, guys, of feeling out period. These guys, as soon as the bell goes, they are in the middle, throwing.
I kind of felt like the first round was a filling out round, but it hasn't. I mean, this pace, this level, it's been here since the very end of the round, the first round.
Look at this, Steve Smoger, unofficial scorecard. Every round going in the way of the Mexican fighter, Eduardo Baez.
Good combination punching inside from Baez when they do get close. As much as Abgaryan is trying to gain back control here, it's falling into Baez's hands. The pace of this fight, the direction, the corners, Sean, you talked about that. You end up there, you're in trouble.
Yeah. I mean, I felt like it was effective for Narek earlier in the fight using his movement. He was able to turn Baez. He was able to keep Baez off balance. But Baez has slowed him down. And he's really starting to connect with just about everything he throws. Big hooks right there. 3 big hooks in a row.
You talked about Kern moments ago, Kern's report about how Baez's corner wanted him to keep Narek in the corner, and he's doing a better job of that. He's not letting him out. He's getting his money's worth when he corners him.
Well, guess what? When you slow a fighter down, where is he going to go? He's going to go from ropes to the corners, and from the corners to the ropes.
Watch your hands. Cuidado con las cabezas, los dos.
Be smart. Don't lean in there like that.
Both fighters kind of in that crouched over posture, which is kind of strange.
I don't want to get all Phil Collins on you guys, but there's something in the air tonight in these fights. We are seeing some fun action. They are getting after it.
It's been a fun night so far. I mean, I appreciate what Baez is able to do.
Put your hands.
I guess we're going to just keep saying it. The Mexican style. This is a very great example of what the Mexican style is. Come forward, very good, very little defense, a lot of shots thrown and a lot of shots eaten. But he's slowing down Narek here in the second half of this fight.
And BC, while we're dropping names, I don't want to go Al Roker on you, but about 5 minutes ago, you guys felt that wind gust come through off the coast. I think it dropped the temperature another 10 degrees. You guys are grabbing your notes.
Did you see that? Yeah, I was grabbing.
Hurricane coming. I've never seen Sean move that fast in a long time.
So, but these guys in the ring, I mean, the blessed position that they're in is they have their adrenaline so high. The will and determination to win to implement their game plans and make them work, that they don't feel this win at all.
And correct me if I'm wrong, if you guys aren't sensing this, but Baez's confidence seems to be growing by each round.
Yeah, I mean, the thing with that Mexican style is you want to get hit. And the more you get hit, the more it pumps you up. I believe that Baez is very pumped up right now.
Abgaryan and Baez going to the next round here in Hollywood.
Okay. How we doing, Narek? Okay?
Hey guys, just try to make you look a little better. If you step into the light and I'm on this side, is that all right?
Great fight underway outside at Wild Card Boxing Club. Inside, Charles Conwell getting loose as he is part of the main event tonight as he goes toe-to-toe with Madiyar Ashkeyev. Both men, perfect records. That's still to come here live on NBCSN, Ring City, USA. We move on to the seventh round of eight. Eduardo Baez on the right side of your screen. Narek Abgaryan, trained under Freddie Roach. Maybe in a little bit of trouble if you believe the musings of one Steve Smoger and his unofficial card. And there it is, guys. So go ahead, Sean, make a case for Abgaryan over Baez.
I gave Abgaryan the very first two rounds. Mm-hmm. I just feel like Baez, he's implemented that Mexican style. He's walked down Abgaryan and just make the fight very difficult for him.
I've sort of been waiting for Abgaryan to figure him out. It's not happening. The adjustment is not there.
It reminds me of something my dad told me really early on in my professional career, maybe even before I turned pro. He says, now that you're about to be pro, you can't just move around the ring and touch somebody. You got to hit somebody with something that hurts and get your respect. And I don't think Abgaryan's got any respect at all from Baez.
Abgaryan, BC, does he have the knockout power? Can he stand in the middle and just fire off one big straight right and drop?
You know, that's certainly a good question. Six knockouts in 14 right. fights coming in doesn't necessarily suggest that. We know he's a classy fighter. He's an accurate, firm puncher. But if he doesn't start putting these punches together, it's time to swing big at this point.
Baez is certainly giving him the opportunity as he is staying right in front of him. Baez, to his credit, also with six KOs in his professional career. Blood continues to pour down from the forehead of Baez, that coming from the second round inadvertent headbutt with Abgaryan.
Both these guys are still, we're seven rounds in, and they're still both. I'm not saying they're all the way fresh, but they're relatively fresh. I can see both guys still implementing the offense and defense that they want to use. Abgaryan is still trying to counterpunch. And then on top of that, Baez is able to hit and then now start to use some defense and make Abgaryan miss too.
Baez snapping the head of Abgaryan back with that short left hook.
Pressure bust pipes, that's what we say.
There's Baez trying to get him into that corner, getting some work, not punching at the same rapid pace he was two rounds ago, but to Sean's point, we're in the seventh of eight round, and this has pretty much been the pace since round one.
I'm not a chess guy myself, Sean. I don't know what to do when the board's covered in blood.
I'm not a chess guy either, but I didn't see the strategy, the strategical type of fight that Abgaryan claimed he would have.
I'm not really a chess guy either, but I can tell you right now, Abgaryan's going to need to take the king to get this thing onto his side because he's got one round to get it done as we listen in.
Deep breath. Come on, one more to go.
Wipe him off, bro. You got him, Mark? I'm going to get this swelling down. Go ahead. Get a good wipe right there. I got it.
Last round. Touch gloves.
All right.
You got it.
It's been all Baez all night. Nice 1-2 right there. The pressure. Pressure bursts pipes. That's what we always say. And he's been bringing the pressure all night. Hands down. Narek, you don't have that kind of comfortable space that you think you have. Right there is another 1-2 clean. Right there, right down the pipe by Baez there. This is the last round. This is going to be a big round for both.
I know what Steve Smoger thinks, so I'll ask you first, BC, and then you, Sean. Are you sensing a big upset here?
I'm feeling it. And Baez told us, interestingly, coming in that he doesn't have much to gain from this fight. He says the pressure's on Abgaryan. There's much more for him from the standpoint of using this fight to advance. Yet Baez is fighting like a champion. He's got the right spirit, the right confidence level. He's walking him down. I loved him throughout.
I tell you what, Ring City doesn't just have boxing on NBC tonight. They got great fighters on NBC tonight. This guy in Baez right here, fighting with determination, grit. You got to feel like you're in control, but he's still coming hard, coming forward, and throwing with a lot of fire right now, too. He's still got a lot of pop on his punches.
Not trying to cruise over this last 2 minutes and 15 seconds. The Mexican superweight champion with his identical twin brother, Leonardo, and a bantamweight fighter. He has shown what he has made of tonight, making his U.S. debut at a Baja California, Mexico.
And look at this. Every time he touches Abgaryan, he's going to get more and more confidence and just keep going. And that's a part of his nature. That's a part of what he does.
Well, look, fortune has favored the bold and the opportunistic this weird sort of pandemic boxing year. This is the fourth fight since the quarantine started for Baez and a 12-month layoff for Narek. You're seeing the difference in terms of being fresh right now.
I could agree with that. I think that, you know, everybody's different, but, you know, that ring rust could very well have sat in for Narek.
Coming up next, still the main event, Charles Conwell taking on Madiyar Ashkeyev. 10 rounds in the main event here, Ring City, USA. Fine with you, BC. I tell you what, Baez has impressed me to the point of, if you believe Steve Smoger, and why wouldn't you unless you're Sean, he's pretty much in control of this fight, but yet he's not going out there just saying, I got it, and I'm just going to cruise this thing home.
Take it easy. I gave 2 rounds to the other guy.
It's your favorite part of the evening when you and Steve disagree.
Now trying to punch with power.
Nice catch there on the left from Abgaryan. Maybe a little too late. Final 30 seconds now.
Big body shot there, too, for Narek.
We needed this earlier, though. We needed this earlier if you're in his corner.
Yeah. Wow. Call it whatever style you want. Baez certainly came to play, and he is standing toe-to-toe with Abgaryan. Chris Punchy, look at that, snapping it off.
In a few minutes, we might call it winning style.
There you go.
El Fantastico.
That was fantastic.
They go all 8 rounds. Narek Abgaryan, under the tutelage of Freddie Roach and Eduardo Baez. 8 complete rounds. We'll have the official decision. We return to Ring City, USA on NBCSN. Welcome back to Hollywood on a chilly night in December as we have reached the main event, Ring City USA version 3.0 from the world famous Wild Card Boxing Club. Charles Conwell Ashkeyev will do battle here in just a moment. For more on Charles Conwell, let's check in with Kerem Bhatia.
On October 12, 2019, Charles Conwell fought a 27-year-old Patrick Day. Charles won that fight by 10th round knockout, but what ended up happening was a tragedy. Patrick Day did not get up from the canvas. He was rushed to the hospital, and he died just 4 days later from the injuries that he sustained. The tragedy sent shockwaves through the sport. In the aftermath, Charles has reached out to Patrick's parents and paid his respects to Patrick's family. Charles wrote an open letter to Patrick and said, I thought about quitting boxing, but I know that's not what you would want. Charles now fights in Patrick's honor. When I asked Charles, I said, why do you continue to fight? He said simply, I gotta be the champion that Pat wanted to be. That's why I fight. Tonight, like he's done before, Charles is wearing a patch on his trunks, which reads, Pat Day, all day. I spoke to Patrick Day's longtime trainer, Joe Higgins. When I asked Joe his message for Charles, he said simply, I want Charles to know that we support him. We want Charles to win. We want Charles's dream to stay intact. And when I asked Joe for his reaction to Charles wearing Pat Day all day on his trunks, Joe said simply, I truly believe that Pat's spirit is now with Charles.
Thank you, Curran. The absolute worst outcome and a tragedy like no other. So as we get set for the main event here underneath the stars in Hollywood, just a week before Christmas alongside the two-time world champion, Sean Porter, I'm Todd Harris. Sean, we get ready now. Let's first talk about Charles Conwell and what he brings with a 13-0 record to Ring City USA.
Charles Conwell's DNA is power. He's a very powerful fighter. And as we look at the highlights that he has, he not only uses power with his hands, but he uses it with his body as well. He uses a shell defense, covers up. He's able to make guys block, and he's got a powerful body so he can withstand those type of punches on his body. He can stay strong, and then guess what? He's coming right back at you. What's he coming at you with? A lot of power to the head and also to the body. He's going to drop. He's going to look to drop Akeyev with some body shots and possibly to the body and take him out.
And Ashkeyev is a very smart fighter, so he's probably seen this same footage, and he has broken it down to what he needs to do to counter it. With a guy with a 14-0 record, you know he's got the skills as well, so obviously someone's will is going to be imposed.
His DNA, I call it controlled aggression. He's a very smart, tactical fighter. He likes to bring the offense. He likes to control the center of the ring, which I think is going to be pivotal for both fighters tonight, but he does it very methodically. He does not waste any punches, does not waste any energy, doesn't use too much movement, not a little, not a lot, but he's going to be right there tonight, right there in Conwell's face, and he's going to try to take him out tonight.
This is just like the Porter viewing room back in Las Vegas, about the same size.
You have never been to my house. You don't know.
I imagine it's probably about that size.
Something like that.
Well, we are set to go with the main event. It'll be Conwell taking on Ashkeyev as they get ready, receiving their final instructions, getting warmed up backstage here at the world-famous Wildcard Boxing Club. You're watching Ring City USA on NBCSN. Just north of the City of Angels, we have reached the main event, Ring City USA, the third edition from the Wildcard Boxing Club in Hollywood. Charles Conwell puts his 13-0 record against Madiyar Ashkeyev of Kazakhstan, who will walk away with a perfect record.
Age is set.
I really like his style. I think he's a real good fighter, but you know. Charles Conwell, I'm going to be in there to fight. I'm going there to dominate, and I'm going there to get that victory.
Their moment has come. It's time to tape him up.
I'm an action-packed fighter. I bring action. I come to fight. I come to win. I'm definitely going there and close the show.
Lace him up.
And
let your fists do the talking.
You're gonna see my hand raised at the end of the night.
Conwell, be prepared. My dad is coming.
It's time for the main event on Ring City USA.
Now entering the ring for our featured bout of the evening. In the blue corner, Madiyar Ashkeyev.
Fighters, they're very
Kazakhstan.
Oh, I'm sorry. Wow, yeah, I see.
You're in the right region, but
I meant Kansas State. You know, I saw the colors.
Yeah, I know.
I saw the colors, and I just kind of lost my mind.
But what a big weekend. Kazakhstan's National Day of Independence was yesterday, this fight, and then Triple G fighting tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, those guys are very patriotic, and I think that has something to do with both of those guys getting in the ring this weekend.
He was very adamant about celebrating and giving respect to his home nation of Kazakhstan, hoping to make it a clean sweep.
Across the ring in the red corner.
Good, I don't need it. Matty, come
Charles
on,
Conwell.
Both these fighters understanding that it would be a chilly night, as Sean Porter alluded to, as an experienced fighter, when you walk outside, the first thing you're going to get hit with is Mother Nature, because the temperature is no joke. Temperature dipping down into the mid-50s with high humidity. We're not too far away from the Pacific coast, so you get that ocean breeze blowing in, and Charles Conwell dressed for the occasion.
Yeah, absolutely. Dressed for the occasion, knowing I'm going to be on national television. Let me bring my best. We'll see who's got the best style in the game.
Charles, can you share the gloves, please?
Look at the blue hat on Charles Conwell's trainer, the Jones. I think he wins, Sean. I think he wins.
Cleveland, baby, that's what we do.
Let's take a look at the tail of the tape for this main event scheduled for 10 rounds. Charles Conwell, 23-32 for Ashkeyev. There you see the weigh-in weights and what they came in today after rehydrating. 5'9" to 5'8", and a 4-inch reach advantage for Madiyar Ashkeyev. Right now, let's send it in to Lupe Contreras for the official introductions.
From the house that Freddie built, the Wild Card Boxing Club, Hollywood, California, this is Ring City USA, presented in association with Bash Boxing, the Bella Entertainment, Holden Productions, and Main Events. Ladies and gentlemen, prepare to be entertained. This is the main event of the evening, set for 10 rounds in the super welterweight division. Our judges at ringside are Dr. Lou Moret, Pat Russell, and Max DeLuca. At the sound of the bell, the man in charge of the ring, referee Jack Reese. Now, two undefeated fighters, but someone's gonna take an L tonight. Introducing first, the fighter in the blue corner. He enters the ring wearing light blue with white trim. He weighed in at an official 154 pounds. Tonight, atop the Ring City USA canvas, he puts out his undefeated record on the line, consisting of 14 victories. 7 of those victories coming by way of KO. Fighting out of Merkel, Kazakhstan, Madiyar Ashkeyev. Across the ring in the red corner, wearing white with baby blue trim, he weighed in at an identical 154 pounds. After an outstanding amateur career, culminating in representing the USA at the Rio 2016 Olympics, he now enters the ring an undefeated pro, with 13 victories, 10 of those victories coming by way of KO. The self-proclaimed best-kept secret in boxing, from Cleveland, Ohio, Charles Bad News Conwell.
Charles, right here, facing me. Facing me, please. Up this way, facing me. There you go. Maddie, right here. Okay, right here. All right, these are just, listen, don't even bother, they're gonna come up. These are a little bit higher, right on the line right here. I'm gonna let it work. You're gonna come up, coach, no big deal.
Mouthpiece.
I give you both instructions. I just wanna remind you, please listen and follow my instructions at all time. Protect yourself at all time. Fight hard, fight clean. Good luck to both of you.
And this main event is being brought to you commercial-free here, Ring City USA on NBCSN, under the stars in Hollywood, California.
No Hot Pocket commercials. I stuck one in right there real quick.
Madiyar Ashkeyev, Charles Conwell.
This is going to be a great
yep.
fight.
Back, go back.
Let's
See it.
Jack Reese in charge of the action. We are scheduled for 10.
Here's what I love about this main event. Both unbeaten, so much at stake for the future of their careers. But did you see the look in Charles Conwell's eyes? He's got a chip on his shoulder. He's open about it. He feels he should be more celebrated for what he's done in his amateur and early pro career. Tonight, he's got the opportunity to prove any remaining doubters wrong.
Yeah, he says, I am boxing's best kept secret. I'm not going to argue with that. You know, he was an Olympian. Most of the Olympians that have gotten to this point, 13, 14, and 0, they've been seen a lot more than he has. I would tell him, win this fight, stay the course. Your time is coming.
Charles Conwell in the white trunks. Ashkeyev in the blue.
Expect some very physical chess early on here in terms of jockeying for position. Maybe not throwing a ton, though, but I think once this fight does open up, it's probably going to stay there.
Temperature continues to fall here. It is December, but you think in Hollywood, maybe a little warmer. 58 degrees, but the 71% humidity is what you're really feeling, Sean.
Again, we're feeling it. I don't expect these guys, if they're feeling it now, it won't take much longer before that adrenaline takes over, that game plan takes over, the will to win takes over, and they won't feel this breeze that we're feeling. I'm suffering. I'm suffering for them.
Probably should have, rethought not wearing socks to the ringside area.
There you go.
Fashion's not comfortable, BC.
Remember what I said. Ashkeyev is very methodical with his movement. He doesn't waste punches. Doesn't waste energy. A couple steps to the left or right, he's going to be in the corner, but he's just going to continue to move and turn. Just like that right there.
He's got a heavy jab. I love his commitment to the body, but stays responsible defensively, as does Charles Conwell.
You see that strength right there? He bumped him off. Strength. That's men's strength. He's 32. That's 32 against 23. That's what we're seeing.
I was waiting for him to say strong like bull. Madiyar finding out. Look at that.
Stop.
Oh, you saw Conwell.
Watch the elbows.
He was ready to.
Hey, listen, let me say this because I was just reminded of it. When I was in the Olympic program, we were warned that those other countries, they fight strong. They fight what we consider over here to be dirty. And you see right there that Ashkeyev is turning and pushing and bumping Conwell.
Finish him out, finish him out,
both fighters trying to end this first round with a flurry as Conwell tracking down Ashkeyev to finish round number one. And Conwell has one mission in the world of boxing, and that is to become the very best.
Being the best is just, you know, just a... it's a bragging right, it's a great feeling. You just know you're the best and that you work hard and that you can just call yourself number one, the number one uno.
What defines being the best for you? Is that being a unified champion? Is that being the pound for pound number one fighter in the world? What would be the best?
I want to be a world champ, I want to be a unified world champion, but I just want to leave a legacy and be a legend. That's what really being the best of me is, being a legend, being a legend in sport.
You want people to remember the name Charles Conwell, right?
Yes, for sure. Charles Conwell, I want that to go down in the books.
So as Charles Conwell's group circles him, very telling early on, as you made a good point, Sean Porter, about Ashkeyev. Get in there is what would you call an MMA dirty boxing.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to call him a dirty fighter or anything right. Like that. Kazakhstan, all of those European countries, they fight very physical. And a lot of us American young fighters, it takes us a while to start to kind of get into that type of professional boxing style.
Not always going to be a clean break.
Yep, not always going to be a clean break. You're going to get a guy turning you, hitting you with elbows, hitting you with forearms.
Stop,
we'll see it here.
Punch. Set each other up, turn around.
Conwell's so comfortable fighting behind that high guard that it allows him to really enter into the strike zone, so to speak, and still be responsible defensively by getting off his own shots.
Yeah, now he's built up a tolerance to his body for handling whatever's coming after him.
Come on, guys, work at it. Charles, let him go. Maddie, pull your arm out.
Mike, stop. My brother. Stop.
Physical.
Watch the wrestling.
This is the style Sean Porter likes to do in the ring. All right, come on.
Physical.
As another gust of wind blows through the back lot here at the Wild Card Boxing Club. Temperature chilly. Look at this. This is what Sean Porter's been talking about. He's very physical.
You're wrestling. Stop the wrestling. Relax. Box.
Jack's like, hey, relax. You guys are in a boxing match, not a wrestling match. But I forgot about this. I forgot that, you know, European fighters are very physical. They use their arms, their shoulders, forearms, all of that. Right there, still going to the body is Conwell. You see, that's a part of his game plan in every fight, but specifically this one. Let me
right
get
there.
To that body.
Yeah. Your elbow, yes.
I think the best thing Conwell did in that last flurry was show that he won't be bullied in this fight.
Yeah.
If you're going to grapple with him, he'll hit you on the break. He'll stand up to you.
That leading left elbow, Ashkeyev, when they get into close quarters, as Sean pointed out, he'll kind of just push him off, but leading with that almost as a bit of a weapon.
Yeah. And I expected to at some point for Conwell to change the nature of the fight. You know, he's leaning in right now, hands up, and he's allowing Ashkeyev to push him off right there. He was even pivoted, which opened up some punches. What I was going to say was eventually he's going to start to make some moves to open up some shots.
Stop. Right there.
This is some high-level stuff at close range. It's getting manly in there. I'm loving this.
Yeah, because the first two fights we had, they were close-quarter fights, but you didn't see the strategy involved in the fight like you do in this fight here.
Well, the same commitment to the power shots, not just looking to land to stay busy. They're looking to end the fight with some of these shots right now.
Wow. There's another push-up. Sean, if you were advising Charles Conwell, would you tell him to get some distance and maybe attack at range?
I would tell him to do exactly what he's doing. Okay. He's been physical right back, and he's throwing and starting to land. That's what he does. This is his game. If I'm Ashkeyev, I'm telling him, use your jab. You got more skills than this. Use your jab and keep this guy off of you.
Time. Stop punching.
I tell you, the bravest man there was
pushing punch.
Which coach was Jack Reese. He stood in the middle of that. I thought he was going to get double tapped.
Conwell.
He panicking.
Conwell's
that's what we want to do.
Too.
Don't let him push you. Quit letting him push you. If he push you, his hands away from his face. Yes. Step back and come up and over. You understand?
Yes.
Don't let him push you. You know what I mean? If he push you, when you're going back, turn your shoulder.
Right here, we see him dig into the body, Charles Conwell. What his coach is talking about right here, when he gets close, back up and get some space and some distance. This guy's going to grab you. He's going to wrestle you, rough you up. Don't allow him to rough you up. And then here later in the round, what I really like was the arsenal that Charles came back with.
Mm-hmm.
Hooks to the body and then to the head. Uppercuts to the body and then to the head.
This is what you want out of unbeaten fighters. Nobody giving an inch right now.
Yep.
Yep. Maddie, number three.
And we knew that coming in. We knew that both guys, they aren't fighters who are willing to take any steps back. Oh. Look at this adjustment. European style. Left hand is straight out front. Measuring you, trying to find the distance, the range and the distance.
Conwell certainly has the speed to get on the inside. Look at him coming with combinations as Ashkeyev decides to force the head down.
Watch that. Stop. Watch your head. Where'd you get it? You all right? No blood.
Work your jab. Don't come in with your head.
Conwell's corner might not want him to come in with his head like that, but he is suffocating Ashkeyev up to this point.
Yeah. Box.
That's one thing people don't know. When you're a good inside fighter, not only are you able to hit the guy, but you're able to prevent him from using his offense.
No.
That's exactly what's happening right now.
I'm out. Give me gloves. Box.
Make no mistake, should this fight get a little bit dirty, Jack Reese, we'll cut that out right away. He'll sniff that out. He'll remove that.
He'll try to. The Cleveland fighter is all game, though. Yeah, he's all game. Whatever you can do, I can do better. Good body shot. Finish with a hook.
Great job by Conwell to force him into the phone booth and make his opponent stay there.
Forcing him.
Conwell coming forward. Great defensive stance.
Good right hand that snuck in there between the gloves.
Not there, Lee. Nice.
Come on, let's go. Boom! Off the
ropes, buddy. Nice. Oh!
Being patient, waiting on the opening. It's Conwell.
Ashkeyev's back foot nearly slipping off the edge of the ring right there.
Hammer!
And look, here's Ashkeyev's game. His game is to turn the guy and put him on the ropes. But he doesn't know what to do against Conwell because Conwell's defense is so tight. He doesn't know where the opening is.
Yeah, how do you score points on a guy that's covered up so well?
I tell you what it's going to take for my Ashkeyev. You got to time Charles Conwell. When Charles punches, that's when your opening is.
Tried the uppercut there. Couldn't get in the inside, and Conwell sees an opening. Gets off a flurry.
All right, stop. My break. Step away from each other. Both you guys, stop it.
Conwell gets him into the corner. See what he can do here.
Stop. Step back. Just let him go. Step away. Stop him. That's it.
We've seen a little bit of everything, guys. We've seen some great rough boxing. Fight, huh? We've seen some dirty boxing. We've seen some fighting. We've seen some throws.
He got to hurt him. He's trying to quit. You know what I'm saying? He's trying to quit. Then when you got him on the ropes, you ain't posting him. Post him and rough him. I said, finals to the chest. You ain't do it. Come on, man. Get better with responding. I see something. Give me what I see, okay? Frontals to the chest, man. He's trying to quit. Get back to his body, frontals to the chest. Squat down. And look for that big shot I'm talking about. We've been working on.
See, bro. Right? Lower jab. Continue with that. More uppercuts after your frontal to the chest, finish with an up. You got a third needle to the chest.
Now I told you to drift.
It's the rough stuff right here. Charles Conwell going to the body. Look right here. Mm. He tried to escape, but even with escaping, he can't get beyond. Grabbing the other guy, and they fall to the canvas right there. Great body shot by Charles Conwell.
All right, let me ask you this, Sean. In the corner of Charles Conwell, he was talking about post him up. What's he referred to when he says post him up?
I love everything I heard from Conwell's corner, and I'm not just saying that because he's from Cleveland. It said post him up. Basically, when he's on the ropes, do that right there. Touch him with your jab and open him up for something. Find the opening. Don't just lay there with him. And then the other thing he said, respond. Do what I'm telling you to do. Every coach wants a fighter that can get in the ring and make the adjustments that they're asking them to make.
All right, let's find out what kind of adjustments Ashkeyev will make. For that, we check in with Kerem Bhatia.
In Ashkeyev's corner, they want him to use the jab and circle around. They don't like seeing his back up against the ropes. They want him to be the aggressor. They want him to back Conwell down.
Stop.
Back
to you guys.
I mean, in an ideal world for Ashkeyev, that'd be the plan, but he's really not using his jab or necessarily focusing on the body as much as the fight has gone on, which is welcoming Conwell right into him.
Yeah, I know one thing from being up against guys like Conwell. You get a guy walking up to you, arms are up, tight defense, and blasting
Maddie,
off.
Let him go, Matty. Work out of it.
Your
let
confidence
go,
isn't there. You don't know what's open. You don't know if you should throw, when you should throw. And I think that's the biggest battle right now for Ashkeyev. It's a mental battle for him.
Well, 404-day layoff for Ashkeyev, and it's taking him a while to get comfortable. At this pace, he may never get comfortable unless he really starts to land something.
It's very true. I believe that fighters, after a host of rounds have gone by, three or four rounds, what you've done in the first round, second round, that's more than likely what you're going to do the entire fight.
Ashkeyev has had his success against undefeated fighters, 3-0 versus fellow unbeaten, but he's run into a different kind of fighter in Charles Conwell, because Conwell seems to have the complete defensive package and certainly the power to just punch his way out of any kind of problem.
Yeah, right there, eating a couple of shots, but then eventually he's going to come right back. Don't hook with the hooker. Now picking up Ashkeyev with the uppercuts. He's picking them up with the uppercuts and then turning off with either a right hook or a left hook.
Sean, we saw Brandon Adams come out here 2 weeks ago and kind of use the same style to blow away Sonny Duverson.
Yeah.
Now we're seeing it from Charles Conwell. I mean, look, we're friends, but this looks a little from the Sean Porter playbook right here.
I don't know if it is or not, and I told Conwell that, I mean, I don't know if this is a Cleveland thing or if this is just something that Conwell does, that Porter
Stop.
Does, and
a
that
punch.
Brandon Adams did.
Separate,
I can tell you one thing. He's got will and determination, Conwell. That comes from Cleveland. That comes from the streets. That comes from your upbringing. And with that being said, this Kazakhstanian fighter is in for a big fight.
Madiyar Ashkeyev trying to run his record to 15-0 and continue the impressive performance by Kazakh fighters.
I know Triple G. I visited him and his brothers. I respect to Golovkin. He showed Kazakh flags for all world. But it's our style is different a little bit. So I have my own path. I can attack. I can move in the ring. I'm too strong. It's my time.
Stepping out of the shadows of Triple G BC, and Triple G will be on display tomorrow night.
Back defending his middleweight title, maybe hoping to eventually get back in the ring a third time with Canelo Alvarez, who fights the next night.
Work.
But right now it's about Ashkeyev and Conwell.
Five. Maddie, five. Stay back. Come on. Stay back.
Oh, we call that finishing with the elbow.
I've seen that before, Sean. I'm sorry. I watched the Andre Berto fight. I've seen that.
Yeah, I knew you.
You knew he was pulling that out.
Hey, it happens. It's a part of the game. Good body shot there by Ashkeyev. Get some space. Get some distance. And let your hands go. In close. Hey, smother the guy and lock him up so that he can't rip off.
Round 5 of 10. This is the main event, Ring City USA version 3 from Wild Card Boxing Club in Hollywood, California. Glad to have you with us so far. This has been a tremendous, well, I'll say tremendous fight, but it's been an interesting fight in contrasting styles as Ashkeyev early on tried to kind of bully Conwell, and he's going to have nothing of it as he stood right up to him, and now it has been Conwell who's really been imposing his will and style on the Kazakh fighter.
I agree, body and head. It's Charles Conwell finishing to the body and the head.
Big body shot.
I felt that
big
from
body
here.
Shot.
Interesting. We're a minute in now.
Yeah.
When Ashkeyev came out, he did something different. He had some space, and he was letting his hands go from the outside. Right here is where he needs to work, whether it's jabs to the body, right hands to the head, jabs to the head. You got to work from the outside. He slowly but surely moved right back into the fighting style that Conwell wants.
Well, if you saw, he showed a little subtle feint, a little stop-start, herky-jerky hesitation. That forced Conwell to step down on his feet and be stationary. We're going to need more of that if Ashkeyev wants to operate from that mid-distance.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Man, Conwell seems to get inside at will, and his punches have been so accurate. If you're Charles Conwell, Sean, talk to me. Where are his eyes constantly? Where is he looking?
You know, it's funny to ask where he's looking. I think he's looking for the openings. When he's going to the body, he's waiting on those elbows to drop so that he can go to the head. And then now you even see him starting to turn Ashkeyev a little bit as well, which just shows that, you know, that's his amateur pedigree, understanding that when I finish, let me turn so you can't get off.
This is the best Ashkeyev has looked since the opening round, Sean.
I agree, and that's exactly where he wants to fight. He's got to see that he's having success right there and keeps the fight right there.
Let this arm go when I tell you, let him go.
This is where we have to ask, Sean, if you're a pressure fighter, you know it better than anyone. It can take a toll on your stamina. Can Conwell keep up fighting in a phone booth for 10 rounds?
Good body shots right there. You know what? As long as he keeps connecting, he'll stay exactly where he's at. I do believe that this is a style he's used for a long time. He understands that that he's a gritty fighter, and he's a fighter that has to have a full tank, even upwards to the last round.
Straight left.
Very good right hand, left hook right there. Wow.
Sorry to come to you first, but I gotta.
Well, does your neighbor have a bigger flat screen TV than you? A better SUV? Well, America's favorite prehistoric family, the Croods, know exactly how you feel. And the new DreamWorks animation movie. The Croods, a new age, available on demand this Friday. The Croods discover that they're not the only family on the planet. This new family has way cooler stuff. Well, at least until the Croods move in. Walking you inside the domain that is Wildcard Boxing Club on a chilly night here in Hollywood.
Hey, when you put him on the ropes, distance.
Straight 1-2 right down the pipe right there. I like to see more of that from Conwell. He can have success on the outside when he wants it. He chooses to fight on the inside. He's a very good inside fighter.
It's busy.
Now's not the time to try anything new. However, you know, moving forward, you can't fight every fight like this, is what I would tell Conwell. Find out what else you can do against an elite fighter like this in the sky.
Yeah, come on. Yeah, use your jab, Mario. Don't just stand there. Give me a feint. There you go.
Madiyar Ashkeyev, originally from Kazakhstan, he's now moved himself and his family to Oxnard, California, just up the coast from Los Angeles, and as BC pointed out, on a 404-day layoff, and that's kind of the commonplace for so many fighters amidst the pandemic, and that is why Ring City USA has been such a heaven sent for so many fighters, and our thanks to Marie and Freddie for opening up the Wildcard Boxing Club for not one, not two, but three versions of Ring City USA to take place here at their establishment.
Very good, very good. Yeah, this was good for boxing. Keep these young fighters going.
Mm-hmm.
There's the SKF jab, something we have not seen consistently, but when he can operate at this distance, it does work for him.
So why lay in there like that? Why lay in there like this?
Oh, that's Cleveland right there.
Yes, sir. Feint of his own, just a double jab right here.
Stop.
Down the punch where he dipped into. Okay.
Lower, Madiyar. Let's go. Straight punches. Come on. Back there. Keep
both guys starting to faint.
Yeah.
I like that. They're thinking in the ring. You're in the second half of the fight. Think. What's going to work? What's going to lead me to victory?
And for more on the action in the red corner, let's check in with Kern Bhatia.
Charles Conwell, of course, fighting out of the Soul City Boxing Club, trained by Otha Jones Jr. and Roshan Jones. Their advice to Conwell between rounds, they see some quit in Madiyar Ashkeyev. They said his body language doesn't look good, and they think Ashkeyev wants to quit soon. In terms of tactical advice, they want Conwell to redirect his headshots. They think he's going for the forehead. They want him to aim for Madiyar's chin. Back to you guys.
Directional punching.
I love the little dance there from Conwell. You know, you're feeling it. You're in a rhythm when you can get out there and show a little Antoine Walker, a little you know what I'm talking about. Roll the shoulders a bit.
I don't know if I've ever seen Antoine Walker dance.
After he would hit a big three.
All right.
Pull your arm out, Charles.
I'm no Sean Porter, but if I'm advising Madiyar Ashkeyev, I'm telling you, you better bring your hands up. I don't care how fast you think you are. You got to get those hands up.
Look, and look at the confidence of Charles Conwell.
Yeah.
He knows that there's no fans out here, but hey, my buddy Sean Porter's right there, and I'm going to show off for him. I love it.
But you put your hands down like Maddie was there when he was doing those head bobs. Conwell will light you up like a Christmas tree.
Yeah.
Right there.
Time, time, stop punching. Listen up, Maddie. Listen up.
There's definitely a Cleveland connection in the house. Not fans being here, so it's a little quieter. Fighters can hear everything, and Charles Conwell hearing exactly what the two-time world champ Showtime Sean Porter's saying.
What you want to do as a fighter, when you can get into a rhythm, when you can get into your groove, I call it fighting in the spirit. Things are just happening the way you want it to. Then you start to smile, you start to dance a little, you start to show off. That's what's happening.
Look at this. He's looking over.
This is unreal right here. This is unreal. And look. And still attentive to what his fighter wants to do. And he said, nah, it ain't happening.
BC, you know what he was really doing. He was looking over saying, what is Sean wearing tonight? What has he got on?
How does he tie that knot so big?
He's telling you lose and he don't know what to do.
That might be the only lesson I can teach him tonight.
Keep how to tie a tie. Body. After this round, we're going to knock him out. All right?
Mean. We'll see if that's a self-fulfilling prophecy as Charles Conwell gets set for round number seven here in Hollywood.
Conwell just 23 years old, as we mentioned, but he's had a lot of maturity this year during the quarantine. The birth of his first child, the daughter Cameron, on June 3rd. Yeah. He says, that's made me train so much harder because I want to leave a legacy that would make her proud. Look, we've seen this before, Sean. For any man or woman, you have that first child that could change everything in your life.
It changes everything. It takes you to another level, emotionally, mentally, and it adds to your game. It makes you want this more. So much power coming out of both hands. This Charles Conwell.
Again with the body shot.
What we call that? We call that barbecue in the ribs. That's what we do. Barbecue in the ribs.
Getting all basted up.
Yeah.
These are some healthy exchanges here. Big hooks from both guys at close range.
I was going to say, you can't sleep on Ashkeyev. He's still very much so in the fight. I don't think he's won very many rounds, but he's still very much so strong and able to pull his fight out.
Oh, mercy.
Double hook to the body. Let's go. Yeah, he felt it.
Coming up on 90 seconds to go here in round number seven. This one's scheduled for 10.
I'm still so impressed by the way that Conwell never let any of the physicality get to him. Yes. He's proven to be the stronger man, the guy more willing to move his opponent around if needed here, and that's been a big change knowing the kind of pressure that Ashkeyev can put on.
Yeah, big body shot there too before the tie-up.
Turn around, Maddie, stop.
You can't do that.
Don't turn your back like that. You understand? You turned your back, you walked away. Thank you. Box.
That's not the Cleveland I know. The Cleveland I know would have taken his head off right there. That's full dog pound.
Referee Jack Reese, he saved this guy right there. You turn your back in a fight, not only could the referee have stopped it, but he could have let Charles Conwell take a free shot. It is protect yourself at all times. If you're Ashkeyev, you got to be thankful that went down that way.
He still had 45 seconds, and I think he thought the round was over.
He's going to keep the fight fair, you know. It's not supposed to happen, but when it does, you have to step in there as a ref.
Maddie, let him go, buddy. Maddie, let him go. You got
to
let him go.
Really foul to
stop. You got to let him go when I say stop. Break.
He's broken. Ashkeyev's broken. Stop. We're going to see some different things.
I'm seeing the same signs.
You starting to see it? He slowed down. That's number one. Mm. Big hook right there. Big hook.
So now we find out the fight or flight. Is he going to come swinging or is he going to be done?
Exactly.
Ready? Now stop. Turn around.
Don't turn.
Turn around.
Again.
Box.
But he's broken. He's turning around because he's mentally
it's the pressure.
Not all the way there.
Charles Conwell delivering early Christmas presents to Madiyar Ashkeyev.
Nah, we can finish it. All right? Now, when he's falling over, you just step in front of him and squat and shoot the up to the hook. You know what I'm saying? Yes. Don't let him off the hook. When he's stumbling around, anticipate his step. And step to him, boop, boop. If he go to the right, shoot the boop, boop. If he go to the left, shoot the hook and get up under there. Give me some money, son. Okay?
Gotcha, coach.
One thing you can't take to a fighter is anticipation. He's telling them, anticipate when he's going to fall around and make it happen.
Look at this.
Ooh. He knew better. He knew better. I hate being here right now. Like, put a big screen up in front of me. I feel like I got more to do with this fight than I want to have.
I'm just wondering if he was looking over and he said, what would Sean Porter do right here? That's what he was thinking. What would Showtime do?
All right, gut check time here for Ashkeyev. What do you have left in you? How bad do you want this right now?
Let him go, Maddie, let him go. That's
the number one thing, and both of these guys are going to learn it.
You got to let go.
Ashkeyev's learning it right now. You have to stay poised under any situation until this fight's over.
Big body shots, big time.
Yep.
Well, Ashkeyev should be okay as far as cardio, guys. He's gone 10 rounds twice in his last four bouts, so this is not uncharted territory for him.
Different ways to break down the fighter. You can break down the fighter physically. You can break down the fighter mentally.
And I think that's where he might be.
He's mentally and now being physically broken up.
Stop.
stop, break, let him go.
Like, we don't know what the future of Ashkayev's career is going to bring, win or loss, but when you've never lost before, you don't know how to face adversity sometimes. You never know what you're going to get. That's why you love unbeaten fighters facing off with this much at stake.
Yeah. Yeah, because at some point he's going to pull something out. He's going to realize that, hey, I'm losing this fight. I got to do it.
He is definitely being dragged into the deep end of the pool, and Charles Conwell is no lifeguard. He is not coming to save him.
Oof. Big overhand right. Swing and a miss.
Stop. Break. Let each other go.
Yes, sir.
Turn around. Pull his head down on that one.
This is the round that Conwell's corner said, this is where we finish him. And he's had opportunities. Can he get it done in this final 90?
Oh.
Oh, my goodness.
What's the adjustment? Every time he's dipped down before that right there, he's gone to the body. And now he's dipping down, but bringing it right up the middle, just like his coach asked him.
Conwell loves that right uppercut. It's been his finishing punch throughout his early career.
Final minute.
Big straight.
Stop, 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 stop. Let each other out. Let each other out.
Go get it, right there.
Body, go to the body, Matty Arts.
Stop, stop. Separate.
At this point, the question is, can you finish?
Yep.
And how do you finish? If you're Charles Conwell, at this point, you know you're controlling the fight. What do I need to do to finish this fight?
Stop, 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 stop. That's all right. No, it happened. No big deal. Listen up. Stop at the bell.
You know what Maddie's saying right there? No big deal. You see how he swung at my head?
Time.
Take it off. Two more rounds scheduled here in Hollywood. Conwell having his way with Madiyar Ashkeyev.
I can't let you take this punishment, Madiyar. Huh? Listen to me. I'm gonna give you one more round. If you don't look, listen to me. If you don't look any better, I'm gonna stop the fight. No, hey, you have to show me something.
You're not yourself. Come on, bring it
hey,
to me.
Hey, one more round. If I don't see a difference, I'm gonna stop it, okay? I don't wanna see you get hurt. Hey? Hey.
Yes.
So now you're gonna have to be a professional and dissect him and break him down in one round. You know what I'm saying? Get to that jab, man, and set them big shots.
Wow, great sound from both corners, and you heard it. Ashkayev's corner telling him, if we don't see something different, we're going to stop the fight.
That's real talk. That's his trainer, Ivan Castaneda, right there, putting it front and center. You bring it this round, or I'm going to take you out of here.
Yeah, get to it. Don't wait. We want to drag him to deep water now.
Oh, I think he's already dragged him into deep water.
Well, you're in the deep now. You're in the deep end now. Rounds 9, rounds 10. These are championship round.
Do you think this is a situation where Ashkayev, who has the perfect record of 14-0, just hasn't faced a fighter at Conwell's level that is just so multifaceted in his attack?
Stop. You know what? Early in the fight, we saw it. He tried to be physical. He wanted to show
tried to bully
that he was strong. Tried to bully him. Once that bullying mentality, that bullying style didn't work,
no extra stuff.
He went away from everything that he has. So I think the fight for him never really got started because he never got comfortable in doing what he likes to do. And now you see him trying to use a pull counter, but it's too late in the fight. Rounds 9, rounds 10, you don't have the same type of speed and quickness that you had earlier on in the fight.
He definitely doesn't have the sting and the punches that he had in round 1, 2, and 3.
Guess what? Charles Conwell's corner, they don't know what was told to the fighter. Keep your foot on the gas pedal, and you may not get the knockout, but you may get the fighter to quit on the stool. This is why you stay consistent in whatever it is that you do well. Don't pull back.
Good body language so far, at the very least from Ashkayev this round. He's responding to the push from the corner, trying to set up that right hand with his jab.
Mm-hmm. Sean, you'll love this football analogy. If you're Charles Conwell's corner,
Do you go into that prevent defense? Do you the cover two and drop back and just let Ashkeyev punch himself out and just stay clean?
You don't, and I'll tell you why. You're not there yet. You're not at world championship level when every fight's a big major fight, big money, and you can afford to, you know, coast your way to a victory. In those fights, the champion, you got to beat the champ. And right now, he's trying to get there. How do you get there? Punch this guy out. Stop this guy.
I mean, let's be honest about the boxing political landscape. Conwell has been on the outside looking in at 154 pounds. He wants to attract the big names. He's got to look impressive. There's no backpedaling into a victory here.
In college football, they call that winning with style points.
Yeah, I mean, you've done everything that it takes to win this fight. Again, how do you finish this fight? I got a feeling he's going to finish strong. I got a feeling he's going to go for a knockout. Coach wants him to, that's for sure.
Credit to Ashkeyev. He has certainly answered, but he is taking a beating here in the final 30 seconds of round number 9.
Let him go, Maddie. Let him go.
Nice tie-up. Can't be mad at it. Nice tie-up.
Well, everything has been responsible, Sean. The defense, the patience, never overextending from Conwell. Really just looking to stay in that pocket, but be smart.
Good hook to the body right there. Very good to the body. I see the arms drop immediately.
Stop.
As good a puncher as Conwell is, his body shots are amazing. Mm-hmm.
Stop at the bell.
Very good direction. Time. Directional punching.
Hey, coach. Foul or something? Come on.
Listen, you're taking too many punches. No, Mari, we can't win this fight, okay?
We lost every round on the scorecard. This is the smart thing. He is not ahead tonight. We're done, right? We're done? Coach? Coach, we're done?
No. Hey, Maria, understand, please. No, you're not. We can't do it. Not today, Maria. No. Maria, please. Maria,
coach,
please.
Look at me.
Please, Maria.
Yes, and we're done?
No, last round. Maria, no more.
Okay.
No more.
I'm stopping it. We're done. We're done.
No more.
Fight's over. We're done. I'm stopping it.
No more. I'm sorry.
Madiyar Ashkeyev wanted to continue. Sean, I'll ask you right off. Did they make the right call?
Yeah, they made the right call. I mean, your guy hasn't won a round, or if so, I gave him 2 rounds through the entire fight.
So why send him out for more of the same?
Exactly. Yep. You're an undefeated fighter. Don't hurt this man's pride. Don't hurt his confidence. Get him out of there safely and come back strong.
I don't know, Sean. I can argue that same point, though, and say because he's an undefeated fighter, because this was the giant test, it is one more round. He's been competitive. Even if he's not winning the rounds, he's been in there. It's been close. But you got to know your fighter, and clearly the corner does.
I think the confidence was a major thing in this fight. And I don't think Ashkeyev ever got comfortable. I don't think he ever had any confidence that he could do anything to beat Conwell. You stop it now, and he doesn't get to fully realize that he couldn't do anything.
And we don't know if his strategy coming in, and Ivan Castaneda can speak to that, if it was to come in and try to bully Conwell and see what he could get out of it, but that plan went out the window after 2 rounds.
Well, our own Steve Smoger did give round 9 to Ashkeyev for battling back there, so it is interesting to see.
All right, let's take a look at some of the action that came from the aforementioned round 9 that, according to Steve Smoger, went the way of the Kazakh fighter. Conwell looking fresh after 9 rounds. Here we go.
Replays right here. Mm. With a guy like Ashkeyev, you just got to find the openings. Right here, the hands are down. Really, there's really nothing you have to look for.
Maria, please. Maria,
coach,
please.
Look at me.
Please, Maria.
Yes, sir, we're done?
No, Maria, no more.
Okay.
No more.
I'm stopping it. We're done. We're done.
No more.
Fight's over. We're done.
And that was the official moment when they shut it down. So Madiyar Ashkeyev goes now to 14-1 as Charles Conwell goes to 14-0. For the official decision, we go to Lupe Contreras.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Jack Reese steps in and calls a halt to this contest at the end of the 9th and penultimate round, declaring the winner by way of knockout, still undefeated, Charles Bad News Conwell.
So Charles Conwell with an impressive performance. BC, early, first two or three rounds, very competitive. Both fighters trying to impose their will. But once that bullying thing seemed to wear off for Ashkayev, Conwell taking control.
You know, and Ashkayev talking to him ahead of time, he thought Conwell was going to be afraid of him. He had a different mindset coming in that he was going to be the more physical fighter, the more technical fighter, the faster fighter. None of those things happened because Conwell really stepped on that gas and made it his style of fight early on. And it barely changed throughout. It was a very dominant performance.
Do you think that Charles Conwell answered many questions by maybe doubters or people that didn't think that he was at the 14-0 level?
I do. I do believe he does with this type of performance.
Well, normally we'd put Kerim Bhatia up there to speak with Charles Conwell, but when you got two proud Clevelanders, I figure you got to let them go at it. So we're going to send it over to Sean Porter, who is with Charles Conwell.
Charles, congratulations, baby.
Thank you.
First fight, COVID's happening. How'd you feel tonight?
I felt good. You know, I'm getting more and more comfortable with the ring with the more experience I get. So, you know, I'm just feeling better, and I'm going to keep getting better each fight.
Do you think this fight went the way you expected it to go?
Yeah. I knew if I broke him down, I can eventually get him out of there. I seen him wear and tear on his body after each round went on. And he was hanging strong, but eventually I got him out of there.
Now, we heard the information coming from your corner. It looked like you were making the adjustments, doing everything that they wanted you to do.
Yes.
At this point, do you think you made the statement that you need to make for the junior middleweight division?
Yes, yes. I think I'm the only contender fighting other undefeated contenders. So, you know, I think that means a lot. I think I'm making big progress, and I'm ready for the bigger paydays, you know?
And a lot of fun with me, man. What was going on with that? A lot of fun with me. You kept looking at me, you smiling. It's not my fight. What are you doing?
You know, I just wanted, you know, it's an Ohio thing. I wanted to show some Ohio camaraderie with you, and I know I just wanted to put on a good show for you, and I hope you liked it.
Look, right here, you're going at this, man. And you know it's the wrong thing to do. Hey, you know better than that.
Hey, I wasn't ever gonna hit him. I knew I wasn't gonna hit him. I just wanted to scare him, put a little fear in his heart.
You are definitely a showman, man.
Yes.
I'm glad to be. I'm proud to be here right now, watching you do your thing.
Thank you.
Hold it down for yourself, your team, in Cleveland. What's next for Charles Conwell?
I just want to keep fighting better and better competition, man. Getting the bigger paydays. Like I said, I'm the only contender fighting other undefeated contenders, and I think I'm making a statement each and every time. So I think the bigger paydays should come. And the more I fight, the more I get better, and the more I'm keep on progressing as time goes on. I'm only 23 years old. I'm only getting better.
Congratulations, boss.
Can I say one more thing?
Absolutely.
One more thing, man. I just want to give a shout out to all my teammates. You know, Jeremiah Lewis Watts. You know, Simba, my big brother Isaiah Steen, Otha Jones, Haven Brady Jr., who did his thing last Saturday, got a TKO. So I just want to thank my team, my family, my coaches, Otha Jones Jr., Roshan Jones, my mom, my dad. And I want to give a shout out to my daughter, Cameron, and my girlfriend, Shaquana. So I just want to thank everybody.
Congratulations to all of you guys. Hey, back to you, Todd.
Well, you two guys that will be watching Sunday Night Football as the Cleveland Browns take on the New York Giants on NBC Sports. Both of them very proud Clevelanders. What a night of fights here in Hollywood. An impressive performance as Charles Conwell in the main event gets the victory by stoppage over Madiyar Ashkeyev, previously 14-0, now drops to 14-1. And there's a look at what took place in BC. It was a great night of fights all the way around.
It really was. And when you put out forth a series like Ring City, it's about giving people a platform to prove what they can do when they step up on an even playing field. And we saw that tonight from the winners and the losers in this one. Great pace set in all of these fights. You really have to love what Eduardo Baez did to really get in the grill of Narek Abgaryan and really surprise him, if you will, with that kind of pressure. We saw the same thing from Paula Torres in defeat against the champion Jelena Mrdjenovich. Fun night. People going after it. That's what we want.
No question about it. We want to thank all the folks that made this possible. I want to thank Marie, Freddie Roach here for opening up Wildcard Boxing Club on the corner of Vine and Santa Monica Boulevard here in Hollywood. And again, 14 fights for Ring City USA coming in 2021. So brighter days certainly ahead and big days ahead as Ring City USA continues to grow, giving fighters who are young and hungry and ready to prove themselves to all the doubters. So a great night comes to a conclusion here. We want to wish everyone a very safe and happy holiday season. Coming up next on Twitch, switch on over, you'll see Eric Priest taking on Angel Mendez Juarez. Thanks for watching the third installment of Ring City USA from Freddie Roach's famed Wildcard Boxing Club. We look forward to those 14 events in some of the most prestigious boxing gyms all across America in 2021. For Kerim Bhatia, Brian Campbell, and the champ Sean Showtime Porter and his Cleveland Browns, I'm Todd Harris saying good night from Hollywood.
Southern Highlands.
Welcome to Wildcard Boxing Club in Hollywood, California. Ring City, USA, version 3.0 on a crisp, cool December evening. We've had a full night of action both on Twitch and on NBCSN Live. Just moments ago, we saw, thought would be maybe the fight of the night, and it certainly lived up to the billing as Charles Conwell keeps his record perfect, 14-0, stopping Madiyar Ashkeyev, who was undefeated at that time. We've got one more fight to go here. Glad to have you with us here on Twitch. Sean Porter, Brian Campbell, Kurram Bhatia joining yours truly, Todd Harris, as we get set for this fight scheduled for four rounds between Eric Priest and Eric Angel Mendez Juarez. As we take a look at the tail of the tape for this one to wrap up the evening in Hollywood, 22-year-old Priest, 6 feet tall, 160, his reach 73 inches for Mendez Juarez, 26'5", 10", weighing also at 160, and his reach at 70 inches. Right now we send it inside to Lupe Contreras.
We continue with the action here at the house that Freddie built, the Wild Card Boxing Club, Hollywood, California. This is Ring City, USA, presented in association with Bash Boxing. This bout, four rounds in the middleweight division. Our judges are Dr. Lou Moret, Pat Russell, and Max DeLuca. The ref in charge of the ring, Raul Kais Jr. Presenting first, the fighter standing in the blue corner, wearing black with neon green, he weighed in at an official 160 pounds. Tonight, atop the Ring City USA canvas, he is making his professional debut, fighting out of Denver, Colorado, Angel Mendez. Across the ring in the red corner, wearing black with silver trim, he weighed in at an identical 160 pounds. Tonight, he enters the ring in his third pro bout with an undefeated record of 2 victories. Both of those victories coming by way of KO. Hailing from Kansas City, Kansas, and now fighting out of Los Angeles, California, Eric Priest.
Fighter Chief, second only, please. Mouthpiece. Fighter Chief, second. Mouthpiece. All right, gentlemen, you receive the instructions in the dressing room. Know what I expect. A good, clean fight. Legal punches here for you. Legal punches here for you. Touch gloves, luck to both of you.
It's been a great night of boxing.
Yeah.
A lot of action. I think we should expect it to continue.
Please,
are we spoiled at this point, fellas?
Ready.
We should demand and expect more from this great sport. I'm ready for more.
Let's go. Let's do it.
So here we go. The final fight of the night. Ring City, USA. And these fellas have been pent up, and they are ready to go.
Good short right hand from Eric Priest. He's going after
it.
Mendez landing a stiff left.
Just the third fight of Priest's pro career, but he's starting to make a little bit of noise there in Justin Fortune's gym in Los Angeles. Grew up in Kansas, but moved to LA to put some focus on his career, and he's been looking good so far. He's a proud Korean-American fighter. You see the tattoo on his left shoulder, and you see the speed and the combination, Sean, early on.
Mendez continues to come forward. Looks like to be the thicker fighter of the two, but definitely, I'm with BC Sean. Eric Priest has some speed in those hands.
He's got some speed. He's got some good skills. He's able to use combinations. And then offense and defense, I'm very big on that. He's able to make this other kid miss as well.
Well, guys, we long know that iron sharpens iron in this game, and Eric Priest locked 60 rounds with super middleweight contender Gabe Rosado ahead of his fight with Daniel Jacobs just over a week and a half ago. That was a fight that was very controversial, went the distance. Great performance by Rosado, who is trained by Freddie Roach. Obviously, Priest trainer Justin Fortune, been a longtime strength and conditioning coach for Roach's fighters, so you see the synergy there.
Well, word of the wise, BC, you might want to get those aforementioned hot pockets ready because Priest has never gone past the second round. Just trying to give you a heads up.
uppercuts and body shots. We're getting a full arsenal from Priest here. It's fast chess is what's going on. I really wouldn't call this chess, but it's a fast fight. And it's a fight that Priest, even though he's being backed up by Kez, he's controlling the action.
Yeah, let's shout out Mendez Juarez here. For a pro debut, he's letting those hands go, not
afraid. Absolutely. Not quite the same accuracy that Priest has, but Mendez, no problem coming forward. He is courageous.
Good jab. Good jab.
I'll tell you what, Priest is winning these exchanges, but that short little right hand there from Mendez Juarez did make Priest sort of take a half step back, at least, Sean, and reassess the situation.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, when you're throwing everything and then you get touched, you're like, oh, wait a minute, what just happened?
There you go.
Mendez is tough.
Yeah.
He's staying in there. He knows what he can do. He can be aggressive, and he can touch you. And that's what he's going to look to do.
Well, it looks like he's willing to take the punishment that it's going to take to get to the inside of Priest. I think that's probably where he thinks he can do the most damage.
Yeah, I mean, he doesn't have excellent hand speed, boxing ability from the outside. I think he understands. I'm gonna eat some. I'm going to give some, too.
There's a big gust of wind blows through.
Big gust.
Wild card boxing club. Nice. They're saying the Santa Ana is going to kick up tomorrow, and that's a major concern for firefighters.
Timing right here, timing down to that right hook. Come back with the body shots, right? When he comes in, you step around him, start digging the left of the body. Understand?
Yeah.
And just the other joint. He's right in front of you. Always W jab.
Deep breath.
Understand? You're going to try and land the right hand.
Priest went in the first round. It was a combination of everything. Hand speed, skills from the outside as well as on the inside. Big right hand. Oof. I assure you guys, it looks worse in slow motion. Priest has never been past the second round, but Mendez, you see right here, he's going to eat shots just like that, but he's going to stand up. He's going to come right back at Priest.
Let's go, second time, huh? Hey, let's turn it up, baby. You get this kid's heart, man.
Tough first outing for Angel right here.
Let's see if Eric Priest can keep the streak alive. Two professional fights. Neither one of them going past the second round.
Trainer Justin Fortune did say ahead of this fight that it only took one workout with the mitts in his gym when Eric Priest walked in to know that they would have a relationship. Sean, it was the same way for Manny Pacquiao and Freddie Roach when Pacquiao came in off the street in 2001.
It's pretty awesome, man. That's how it happened. When you see that someone's got something special, and all it takes is a great coach. You know, we'll look to see if Priest's coach can bring out the best in him.
Mendez willing to throw with Eric Priest. Ooh. Look at that combination. And there's a stunner. It puts Mendez down onto his knees.
5, 6, 7, 8. How you doing? Walk to me. Hands up. You okay? Yeah. There you go.
That was a clean right from Eric Priest. It found its mark, and he's coming back for more.
He's still light. Right on his feet.
Mendez in full survival mode.
Priest can't miss with these power shots, one after another.
He's got a long way to go. Mendez still 90 seconds in this round. And
there you go.
And that is it. The streak is alive as Eric Priest goes to 3-0, all three wins by way of KO in the second round or earlier. Boy, that was sharp.
Yeah, that was sharp.
I mean, crisp.
It was quick, man. Those right hands were landing, and I was feeling it.
Just 22 years old, young Eric Priest here. Looking, hey, it's early. Three fights in. Looking pretty good, though.
Yeah, you got to understand, I got room to grow. I can learn some things. I can grow and mature. And I think Priest, he's got a good chance of growing really quickly.
Okay. In sport.
Interesting story. Eric Priest, trained by his father at an early age, the former Navy Special Forces, teaching his son the art early on. Attended Purdue University, 2017 Kansas Golden Gloves champion, and what a performance as Priest, now 3-0.
Man.
Look at the first knockdown.
He's no joke. I thought he was going to be able to stand up to these shots, man. Good body shot right there.
Triple.
Almost like a shocker.
Yeah.
And then he dropped him with the overhand right. That body shot, it's almost like it shocks you and it freezes you for a moment. And then he comes back in for the finish. And then he doesn't even go down from that.
Yeah.
I mean, he's strong. Strong kid is Mendez. Just overmatched tonight against Priest.
Raul Kai's sensing that fighter was in trouble as he's Man, yeah, he's not sure what count he's in.
He sent his hair. Look, his hair is going.
That was a smart stop.
Curran, is that what you would look like? Yeah, that's it.
Curran's got way better hair than that. Come on. Don't shortchange him.
Curran, pretty talented guy. Definitely hired for his hair, though. And you gotta respect that, all right?
So a nice performance after a long wait for Eric Priest as he gets the win. Second round stoppage by Angel Mendez as we send it inside, get the official word from Lupe Contreras.
Here at the Wildcard Boxing Club, an accumulation of punches obligates referee Raul Kais Jr. to stop the contest with an official time of 1 minute, 31 seconds of round number two. Your winner by way of knockout, still undefeated, Eric Priest.
Great performance by Eric Priest. Brian, Sean, final thoughts on tonight and what we saw.
Go ahead, BC.
Well, look, you make important fights between unbeaten fighters or people looking to make a statement, and you give them that platform in a 17 by 17 ring. Sometimes you get great results. Tonight was great for pressure fighting and people coming out of their shells. Charles Conwell, I'm seeing a future as a 154 title contender after a performance on a platform like this.
And I'm going to correct you, BC. We got a fantastico performance.
Oh, look at that.
All these guys tonight.
Eduardo Baez.
That's a world-class pivot right there.
There you go. Yeah, he did a fantastic job tonight as well. I think all of these guys, under these conditions, I'm not going to fake the fun. It's cold out here. For you to come out here, stay poised, and handle it the way that these gentlemen have. Congratulations to everyone tonight.
No question about it. I don't want to forget Jelena Mrdjenovich getting the fight victory, as well as Stefan Shaw, unanimous decision. Eric Priest finishing off the night here on Twitch in Hollywood. Crisp, cool conditions, just like his punches, very crisp, and forcing the referee to stop this one in the second round. That'll do it on behalf of Curran Bhatia, Brian Campbell, Lupe Contreras, Sean Porter, and our entire NBC Sports crew. I'm Todd Harris saying good night from Hollywood, California, and the world-famous Wild Card Boxing Club. We wish you all a very happy and healthy holiday season until we see you in 2021.